at same NCSI 2017, we had met with a young college graduate who was completing his engineering and was incubating at one of our ecosystem partner venture center. And he was trying to find a solution to a very pressing problem, which is of used sanitary pad. A sanitary pad on an average takes about 800 years to dispose. 98% of all the sanitary pads that are used in India, they end up either in landfill or in the water bodies. This young man was someone who was thinking of creating a solution for this problem. If it was possible to solve this problem, it was a significant problem to solve. It brought out the best of things that we have in the Pune ecosystem with a smart guy who wanted to make a difference. And that journey began with this smart person called Ajinkya Dharia presenting a solution like this at NCSI 2017. I'm very proud to tell you, in 2 years since, many milestones have been attached. Many milestones have been achieved by him. He developed his technology, successfully licensed to one of the leading industrial houses. During time of COVID, he pivoted his solution to create something which was of peculiar use for COVID, a UV-based sanitizer, which was to be used in hospitals. In terms of media milestone, he was recently featured by CNBC on their program where his story was talked about. He has appeared in numerous awards, numerous conferences, and significantly, he did a significant fundraise for his company right now. With this, I wanted to highlight some of the things that we do, the best of the things that we have achieved in this program, pivoting, working with industry, academia partnership, fundraising, publicity, Pune ecosystem, where venture center, patent generating innovation, mentorship. As I welcome you all to the 8th edition of NCSI, this is the kind of story that we look to create. In last 3 to 4 years, we have been able to create 33 such stories, and we are going to be hearing about 18 more such stories this year. With this, I would want to welcome our chief guest, Shri Srikant Vaidyam, President Pune International Center, Dr. Mashelkar, Vice President Pune International Center, Dr. Vijay Kelkar, Trustees of Pune International Center, Director Pune International Center, Mr. Prashant Kirbane, Associate Director Pune International Center, Trustees of Pune International Center, our partners for this conference, TIS and NIF, our Advisory Council member, mentees, fraternity people from the ecosystem, members of media, mentors who are associated with the program, past innovator, past mentees, and everyone in the audience. It's my privilege to work as the honorary fellow of this August program, Social Innovation Lab, that we had created. And I've had the privilege to run it at Pune International Center. We are looking to create stories which are going to create a deep impact using science and technology. So I'm not going to take too much of your time. I am going to introduce and pass it on to someone who laid the idea behind this program, who propounded of creating more from less or more. So it's my extreme privilege to welcome and pass on and invite President Pune International Center, Dr. Raghunath Mashelkar, to address us and give his welcome remarks. Over to you, sir. Thank you.
Thank you. Thank you very much, Hitendra, for those wonderful words. I want to welcome you all, our chief guest of the day, Srikant Vaidyam, will join us a little later. Dr. Vijay Kelkar, our beloved Vice President here, the trustees of Pune International Center, the entire family of Pune International Center, our partners, Tata Institute of Social Science, National Innovation Foundation, the social innovators, 18 of whom will be giving the getting the award, ladies and gentlemen. This is a very special day. I think great ideas are born with great minds, and I remember it for Dr. Vijay Kelkar's idea to start this dialogue on social innovation on this special day, 17 November. This time we are holding it a little later than 17 November for obvious reasons, COVID being the culprit in some sense or the other. We are also holding it virtually rather than physically in Yashoda. I must say that we are celebrating, as Pune International Center, a decade-long memorable journey. We were formed in September 2011. Normally, it is my practice to always introduce Pune International Center to new invitees, people who don't know about Pune International Center. It's essentially a think tank. After our journey began, we have conducted over 200 plus programs. We have been in the policy space driven by Dr. Vijay Kelkar. We had more than a dozen policy briefs on various issues. They range from climate change to environment, to black money, to corporate governance. And I dare say we have made a major impact. We have 400 founding and life members from different walks of life, be they industrialists, corporate heads, academics, social, cultural, civic leaders, 54 prestigious institution members. We have a number of flagship programs. For example, Pune, the PDNS is one of the very important program, Pune Dialogue on National Security, and National Conference on Social Innovation is really a great flagship program of PIC. As it was mentioned, this is the eighth year of NCSI. It originally started as a platform to bring together the thought leaders from social sector, and the program since then has evolved to become a platform to curate, to bring to fore the social entrepreneurs from all over India. And these entrepreneurs, social entrepreneurs, they're building products, they're building services to help and improve the quality of life for the poorest, the marginal segments of society. And we have seen what coronavirus pandemic has done. The whole world is in a reset. Lives have been lost. Livelihoods have been affected. In 100 days, 100 million families moved from poverty to extreme poverty. The inequalities were, they have increased exponentially. So somehow or the other, the social innovations who caters to the resource poor people has become even more important in 2020s, which has been, I would say, if you look at volatility, uncertainty, complexity, and ambiguity, the VUCA word, as we call it, 2020 has been really the VUCA year of the whole world. So innovation has become the key. Social innovation has become the key. Inclusive innovation has become the key. And we are not just looking at sympathy, we are looking at empathy, we are looking at compassion. And this empathetic innovation is the key for the day. We also believe that everyone is someone. And my friend Anil Gupta, in fact, I would say my guru, our guru, Professor Anil Gupta says, minds on margin are not necessarily marginal minds. And therefore, when we reach the rural areas, when we reach the tribal areas, you'll find fantastic ideas that flow out. And you'll see some of them during today and tomorrow. We received more than 100 plus applications from 18 plus different states. I'm very happy to see the expanse of these ideas, Andhra Pradesh, Chhattisgarh, Jharkhand, Meghalaya, Nagaland. And most importantly, I'm very happy to see the presence of women thinkers and ideators. There's a very healthy participation from female applicants this year. So we have so far provided a platform to more than 125 social innovators. We have participated in NCSI over the last 7 years. The program, by the way, is not just hearing the social entrepreneurs, but connecting them where the ideas can be converted into action, because that's what matters. And we have had the corporate social representatives responsible. Every corporate is mandated now with CSR, 2% of the net profit going for corporate social responsibility. So we have been able to get these people and connect them with the social innovators. So we are connecting the supply and demand, if you like. And we have also been welcoming friends from our incubators, accelerators, impact investment world for the past 3 years. So our job is to get all of them together. I must also say, once again, it is my friend Dr. Vijay Kelkar who has all these bright ideas. And he had this idea about a social innovation lab. And we started in 2007. And we have created this wonderful social enterprise mentorship program for the last 4 years. And this program is currently mentoring 20 social enterprises in the scaling up journey from the prototype to development stage. Because finally, it is not the power of ideas, the power of execution. And finally, how do we move from ideas to impact? So that's what we are doing. We always begin this program on 17 November. We begin this program with Anjani Mashelkar Inclusive Innovation Award. As you know, this award was set up in the memory of my mother. And we have had a decade-long journey. Just as PIC has had a decade-long journey, Anjani Mashelkar Inclusive Innovation Award has also, this is 10th year of the award. And I wanted to hold it on this day, but Vijay, being what he is, he said no. 17 November, the day she left all of us, my mother left all of us, is a sacrosanct day on which you must hold it. So we had already held it. So you have this particular part that you will see now, including my own speech about the Anjani Mashelkar Inclusive Innovation Award, which I have normally given in a pre-recorded form. So that's what the beginning of this two-day fantastic event is going to be. So over to you, Mandar, to Prashant and to Hitendra, to take it forward.
Thank you very much, sir. Thank you for your wonderful talk and inspiring and insightful speech. We would now request our team to play the pre-recorded video of the Anjani Mashelkar Award.
This event today is special since this is the 10th year of the award. But it is even more special because this year, 2020, has shown us the importance of the very subject of the award, inclusive innovation. The coronavirus pandemic has caused an unprecedented devastation in terms of loss of lives, in terms of loss of livelihoods. Within just about 100 days, 100 million families plummeted from poverty to extreme poverty. The inequalities went up exponentially. The only way to recover is by accelerated inclusive growth, driven by inclusive innovation that can achieve the magic of access equality despite the income inequalities which have risen. I talked about the pandemic, but my mother, Anjani Mashelkar, was a victim of another pandemic, the perennial pandemic of poverty. When she gave birth to me 77 years ago in a village, she brought me up facing all the odds that an extremely poor, widowed, uneducated mother moving to Mumbai with her only child a six-year-old boy would face. And this she did with courage and with dignity. When she passed away, we found all the money I used to give her whenever I used to meet her coming from Delhi to Pune or whatever over the years. And she had tucked away all that money in her cupboard with a note in her own handwriting. We simply said, use this money to do some science, do some good for the poor. To honor her wishes, I instituted this award 10 years ago and for rewarding breakthrough solutions for excluded members of our society. Our winners, of course, have gone on to win even more awards. But merely winning more awards is not what makes them special. It is the difference that they have made to the lives of the people, each one of them, that you see here. Whether it is IBRIS exam of Mihir Shah with a handheld, non-invasive device that offers painless breast exams for what? For just $1 per scan. Or whether it is Rahul Rastogi's Sanket Life, which I have in hand. This is a handheld portable ECG, by the way, that brings affordable cardiac care at just 5 rupees per scan to everyone. And all other awardees have done something similar. And of course, many have made a difference beyond the borders of India. For example, AxioStart by Leo Mavlik that stopped bleeding instantly is now in 40 countries. Just as Shyam Vasudeva's Trinetra, a non-invasive, low-cost pre-screening device for 5 major eye diseases has reached 25 countries. So we are making a big difference. Some of them will even lead to radical social transformation. Just take one example. Last year's winner, Gen Robotics, which created Bandicoot, which is a robot that cleans manholes. It can replace the man in the hole, which is a shame itself, by the way, a man in the hole with the machine in the hole. And further, they give dignity to that manual scavenger by training them as robot operators, not they're remaining as manual scavengers, as robot operators. And I'm delighted that our government is bringing out a new bill now, the Prohibition of Employment as Manual Scavengers and their Rehabilitation Amendment Bill 2020, which proposes complete mechanization of sewer cleaning. And for doing that mechanization, which the policy will bring out, we are fully ready. Full-scale use of Bandicoot and other similar mechanizations will be transformational in removing the shameful curse of manual scavenging, which would have lived for centuries. Finally, I would like to thank International Longevity Center of India, which was the birthplace of this award, who helped in launching this award, and also Pune International Center, which gave the award a national platform by making it a part of National Social Innovation Conference on 17 November every year. And finally, the jury. Each one of them a leader in their own field. I would like to thank each one of them individually. Professor Anil Gupta, the father of grassroots innovation in India, he's the chairman of the jury. Arun Nigwekar, the former chairman of University Grants Commission. Bhushan Patwardhan, the iconic and most revered Ilaben Bhatt. Jayant Dumranikar, Professor R. Kumar, Samir Mitra Gotri, Samir Brahmachari, Shiladit Sengupta, Vinod Goyal, Vijay Bhatkar, and Sushil Bode. You all have helped me in making my mother's wish a reality. Thank you very much.
Thank you, Dr. Mashalkar. Your inspiration has fueled this inclusive innovation movement over the last 10 years, and we look forward to more in the future. Friends, we will now announce the much-awaited awards. In the non-COVID, the winner of the Anjani Mashalkar Inclusive Innovation Award 2020 is GOVO Healthcare for Save Mom. Let me now read out the citation. Globally, lakhs of women die preventable deaths every year due to pregnancy-related complications. Save Mom is an IoT-based maternal healthcare solution that monitors a mother's health using smart wearables that collect various physiological signals continuously. GeoVio has collaborated with government and NGOs to provide 1,000 days care to mother and the child for rupees 1,000 only, that is 1 rupee per day, covering 15 antenatal checkups of the mother and postnatal baby care. Save Mom is already deployed in over 100 villages in India and has benefited more than 2,000 pregnant women by conducting over 22,000 antenatal checkups. Let me now invite the founder of GeoVio and pioneer of Save Mom, Senthil Murugesan, to accept the award and tell us more about the innovation. Senthil.
Thank you so much for this recognition. And I'm very honored to receive such a prestigious award award for this innovation. And myself, like Dinesh, co-founded this company on 2016. Our objective is to provide high quality digital healthcare accessible to everyone home. This started especially on 5 years before when my sister was pregnant. So the main challenge my sister faced is she started missing those antenatal checkup. I asked her the reason why you are missing antenatal checkup, which is very important. She told me that every checkup involves a travel, 5 to 10 kilometer travel, and 3 to 5 hour waiting time in the hospital just to get a 3 minute consulting from a doctor. As an engineer, what I did is like I directly went to the doctor and asked every checkup why it takes so much time in the hospital and what you are doing there. So the doctor told she will collect all her vital information and symptoms, and based on that, the decision is taken and the care is given to her. So I asked the doctor, instead of my sister coming here every time, if you get all the vitals digitally, will you be able to take a decision or not? The doctor told, yes, of course, if I get the data, I can give a proper consulting for her. So these are the devices available in the market. The problem is it has a display and it's showing the data to you. As a patient, you can't predict or interrupt those data. So as an engineer, what I did is I removed the display and all the device and quickly done a prototype where a simple application, which is given to my sister, and I told, whenever you click this application through Bluetooth, it collects all your vital information and send one SMS to the doctor. In that SMS, doctor will receive her vitals and symptoms. If everything is okay, the doctor presses good. So I send a nice smiley to my sister saying that you are good and safe. No need to get panicked. If a doctor finds some abnormality, she can press bad. I will inform her husband. And in the meantime, I will book an appointment in the hospital system to avoid waiting in the hospital. This is a small prototype I did. After delivering her baby, she told me that she really had a very wonderful experience, because most of them, she search internet for every symptoms. Like we search, we have a shoulder pain. The internet will throw that it can be a symptom of heart attack. After seeing that search result, we might get that real panic. This is what exactly happened to her. But after this innovation, my sister felt the doctor is always connected. If there is something happened bad to her, the husband also know before like he manually informed her. So that created a very positive experience for her. So from there, I started deeply researching about pregnancy in India. And I found that every 2 minutes, a woman dies due to this pregnancy-related complication. And country like India, every day, almost 800 mother dies. So I went to the village in Ooty to Wayanad tribal region, which has the highest maternal mortality rate. So I started interviewing a lot of pregnant mother in the region. One lady told me that the previous pregnancy, the baby died inside the womb, and this is her second pregnancy. I quickly went to the nearest primary healthcare center to get her mother and child report card. But the card says that the baby born successfully and it has an age of 2 now, and the parents received some 10,000 rupees government money. There is a signature. I took this report card to them, but the entire family was really shocked to see that. The husband told me that the hospital is 20 kilometers away from the home. So she never take her for the hospital checkup. So I directly went to the district officer to know the reality. Is the family is correct or in a PHC data is correct? He redirected me to the nearest rural hospital to collect 2 year baseline data. When they are preparing the baseline data, I observed that they are using some standard Excel sheet, and with the template, they are filling all their vital information and record in a very manual way. And she take print out and give it to me. And she told me that whenever anyone from government or WHO come and ask for the report, and this is the method she has to produce the report. Here I understand that government has world-class pregnancy scheme. But the problem is there is no digital way to ensure that the mother is taking the care. So people could be able to fake the data and submit the faked report to the government. So here, what I have done is I used the innovation which I built for my sister. I used here. So the thing what I implemented is a medical device, kept it in the health worker bag. And every month, the health worker will go to their home to collect her vital information digitally. Here, they can't enter the data manually in the application. It should be collected digitally. And the collected data will be sent to the doctor for further feedback and screen. And second day, based on the doctor's feedback, the care provider will go to their home to provide nutrition and tablet. And all those high-risk mother will be taken to the nearest hospital for further screening. The system is completely digital and transparent. The district administrator know how many of them pregnant and all those high pregnancy mothers are getting follow-up care or not in a digital form. But after deploying this solution, like 2 months, everything's worked fine. But the challenge is we started observing a data, which is very weird. Sometimes the data are in same. We are wondering how this health worker could be able to manipulate the digital data. So we directly went to the PHC and we found that they're very smart. They're using this medical device to their colleagues to collect every pregnant mother data in a very digitally, they could be able to fake the data. So I started interacting with the health worker and she told me that it's a 10 to 15 kilometer. If I do proper checkup for everyone, I'm not get properly incentivized. And this device are very bulky. I could not able to carry it in a longer distance. Even though myself, I carried along with her and I found the device are bulky. So what I have done is I made this device, which is exactly like your 5-inch mobile phone, collects more than 10 vital information digitally by just holding the device on the pregnant mother hand. And the data are collected digitally and directly sent to the doctor for the feedback. Second important thing is how you ensure that this data are collected in a real-time basis. So what we have implemented is we designed a wearable device, which is gold color bracelet design we gave. So the idea is whenever the pregnant health worker goes near to the pregnant mother, the wearable device will give authentication. It say, this is the pregnant mother. Now you are in front of Priya. So there 15 days activity data will be collected and all the vitals will be collected together from the mobile application. But some of the pregnant mother, we found the data are very weird, especially on activity data. And we found that we again went to their home and started interacting with them. So your data are very abnormal. Sometimes it's 100,000 steps in a day. And we found that this lady don't have this gold color bracelet. We asked her, did you lost the device or where it went? And she responded, the husband took the device because he say, this you are sitting in the home, or you need a gold color watch, give that to me. So whatever data we collected is actually a husband data. Due to that, our system could not be able to identify those high-risk patterns. So we thought of to educate the husband, but there is another pregnant mother near to them. She also don't have a wearable. And she told me that this is a very glory luxury device. So I felt very uncomfortable to wear outside. So whenever I go outside, I keep the device inside home. So we found the technology does not solve the problem. It's more on the cultural innovation we have to do. And all these mothers, we observed that they have something like a beads in every one. So I asked them, do you wear this all the time? And every lady told me that this is our traditional wearable, like everyone wears. So what we have done is I completely redesigned the product in a very small chip, which can be attachable to their existing wearable. And this is the form factor I would like to show. The main bead is a sensor, which collects her activity information and store it inside the device. And it has more than 6 month battery life. That means throughout the pregnancy, they don't need to recharge the device and they don't need to feel they are wearing some gadget. The small piece of the device, they can attach with any wearable what they already wearing, and that particular wearable become a smart wearable. By deploying this innovation, we ensured that every mother is getting this data and collected data will be synced to the doctor for further feedback and feedback from the doctor. We have deployed this for throughout almost 18 months in that region. And we want to say the another big challenge is after identifying those high-risk mother, we convince the local government to provide a very quality nutrition food. But once we provided the food, still their weight is continuously decreasing. So when I went to their home to interact with them, what they are doing with the nutrition food, this lady, whatever nutrition food we are giving, she will give it to their family and their children. She never consumed this device. So here again, we come up with another hack. We found that whenever we talking to her, she felt very hungry. She has a small pot of water and she continuously drinking the water. So one pattern we observed, she is taking a water continuously. And next iteration, I instructed the health worker, once your checkup is done, make all this nutrition in a powder form factor and put it inside the pot and add some kind of a bitter taste so that the children or husband never touches the water. After doing a small changes in the pattern, for them, they are continuously drinking water, but now it is highly nutritionized. So after 3 months, the doctor told me that suddenly everyone weight started increasing, their anemic problem is going down. So we ensured that the data is collected digitally and there's a proper transparent system. And the nutrition also, they could able to consume the nutrition based on their need. This is a small change we did. And after first iteration, there is a new baby born in the village. So they invited me. I was in the village. Everyone, the village people gathered in the region and they are holding this newborn baby from one hand to other hand. So I asked this lady's mother what they are doing with the newborn baby. And she told me that she just gave the baby to me. And she told me that this is the first time in their village they could able to feel the weight of the baby. And the baby is smiling. So no one seen a smiling baby after the pregnancy. So every people in the village gathered to experience that. And as an engineer, I have developed a lot of application innovation, but I never touched my output in a physical form. So this is the first time I felt I could able to feel my output in a very physical form and it's smiling in front of me. The amount of satisfaction it gave me is really good. So this project was deployed almost 17 tribal villages, very, very inaccessible region. With the IoT-based innovation, we could able to continuously monitor the mother and we ensure that they get 16 antenatal checkup throughout the pregnancy and we provide 1,000-day transparent maternal and child care. And till date, we have served almost 22,000 antenatal checkup for this mother. And this was globally recognized. We got awards from a global forum, especially we are very honored to receive this award. And the important thing is I have done this innovation from my hometown, Madurai. It's a small town, tier 2 city. Most of the people don't believe people can innovate from this smaller town. But my model is I have to do it from my hometown, not in a major city where the startup ecosystem is there. So I built the entire team of girls in a local town to build this innovative product. And it was recognized by a Google for India conference. So for the past 5 years, I have built the largest woman developer community in my hometown. Using these girls, we are keep on solving the local problem. One part is this pregnancy, but we have done so many innovation locally from Madurai, which is useful for the community people. And thank you so much for this opportunity.
Thank you, Senthil. Save Mom is an outstanding example of how problems have to be solved relentlessly at every step while co-creating with the users. Well done and very proud, Senthil. We now move on to the second category, the COVID category. And the winner of the Anjani Mashelkar Inclusive Innovation Award 2020 in the COVID category is Dozy. Let me now read out the citation. India requires approximately 270,000 ICU beds, almost 3 times the current number, to avoid preventable COVID-19 deaths. Most ICU beds are concentrated in the private sector and are inaccessible and unaffordable for most patients. Dozy is a continuous contact-free vitals monitor with remote monitoring capabilities that converts any bed into a step-down ICU in less than 2 minutes. Based on ballistocardiography, Dozy has medical grade accuracy of 98.4% and costs only 1/10 of current alternatives. Since the outbreak of COVID-19, Dozy has helped thousands of patients in India by providing them with ICU beds. I now invite Mudit Dandavate, the founder of Dozy, to accept the award and tell us more about the innovation. Mudit, please.
Thanks a lot for this wonderful recognition. And Dr. Mashekar and his entire team who has worked relentlessly, Judy, who has selected us out of so many entries that were received. And I'm really humbled to receive this award. Want to really take you through this entire journey of how we went about creating this context-free vitals monitor.
Here's what convinced me about the importance of having Dozy as a remote health monitoring device. We had an elderly patient living alone. Her daughter had placed Dozy under her mattress so that both she and us could monitor her vitals at the healthcare facility remotely. This one time we got an alert indicating a decrease in her heartbeat levels from the device. When we inquired her regarding that, she just brushed it aside, telling that she was just feeling a little bit tired that day and passed it off as an age-related problem. So we called her in for an additional medical test and found out that she had an abnormal heart rhythm, and ultimately she needed a pacemaker for that. Possibly without Dozy, it could have been fatal for her.
Dozy is India's first contactless remote vitals monitor. Its thin sensor sheet, once placed under the mattress, tracks person's heartbeat, respiration, sleep, blood pressure, and even tiny heart wall movements with medical grade accuracy. Once connected, the vitals can be easily monitored on the smartphone app and on a patient monitoring system. A centralized web dashboard where hundreds of patients can be monitored at once. This is how Dozy is helping hospitals to monitor the entire ward remotely.
We are able to convert our COVID wards into step-down ICU within hours at a fraction of cost with Dozy. It has reduced the workload for both doctor and nurses, and also exposure to the infection tremendously. This is because now we are monitoring COVID-19 patients remotely, as Dozy can be combined with SpO2 sensor too. The best part is we can customize alert for each patient and take a necessary action when required. This helps a lot in improving our daily workflow. At ESIC Hospital, we are able to timely shift patient to ICU based on alerts.
Dozy can be used on any number of patients and with any commercially available mattresses. It requires no maintenance, and it can even be integrated with the hospital's EHR systems through our APIs and SDKs. Dozy has been supported by the Government of India, Bill and Melinda Gates Foundation, and various other organizations.
With more and more consultations going online, Dozy is helping provide better healthcare outcomes to thousands of patients at home. It is also helping many leading hospitals to create step-down ICUs.
Continuous non-invasive monitoring of health vitals will be an integral part of future medicine, and we at Dozy are happy to provide it today.
It has been proven more than 98.4% accurate compared to medical-grade devices. We have 4 patents and more than 5 research papers which have been published. The best part about Dozy is that it very easily integrates into life of user. I think Senthil also mentioned that the best way, if you want people to really adopt the solutions, is to really integrate into their life really well. Dozy literally makes it very, very easy. All that users have to do is just go and sleep. No wires, electrodes, anything needed to be attached. The data is uploaded directly to the cloud, and which can be accessed remotely on a remote dashboard, requiring no maintenance, no consumables, almost 20 times cheaper than the product used in ICU. And the best part, it requires very little technical expertise. So anyone who knows how to operate a mobile phone can even operate and set up Dozy as well. Today, Dozy is providing care in more than 40 institutions. More than 5,000 users at home are currently using Dozy to continuously monitor their parents, and also their doctors can see their data as well. More than 7,000 COVID patients have been monitored at COVID care centers, quarantine centers, hotels turned into COVID care centers, and even step-down ICUs, where they are continuously being monitored by the nursing staff, keeping them safe as well. And in this entire time, the biggest satisfaction which both me and my team has is that at times it has been able to tag AI-driven alerts which Dozy lets you customize and put it to each and every patient. And it has proven life-saving, causing early ICU transfers, literally touching lives, which is the dream of any innovator. COVID-19, Dozy has proven a lot of assistance to wards as well. In Tamil Nadu, converting general wards and helping them with step-down facilities. Even at home as well, there have been multiple stories where Dozy has proven life-saving by proactively and preemptively alerting people about their deteriorating health condition. When I'm talking about step-down ICUs and things like that, these are at remotest of places, in places like Chengalpattu Medical College, ESIC Hospital, Bangalore, in Rajasthan district over there as well. So all across India, we have been creating an impact. We are looking for more and more partners to create this care, take it to where patients are at their home, in wards as well. And let's create a health revolution. Thanks a lot for recognizing us with this award. And we're really looking forward to digitizing this entire transformation of healthcare and making healthcare accessible by making it simpler and take it to each and every individual, not just in India, but everywhere as well. Thanks a lot.
Yeah, thank you, Madhit. Your story is very inspiring and a great example of how high technology can be applied to solve unique problems, that too at ultra low cost. Dozy, in my mind, is one of the best examples of repurposing technology for COVID. Hearty congratulations to both the winners for ending the decade of inclusive innovation with such great products. I would now like to invite Dr. Arya Mashelkar to please deliver his closing remarks. Thank you. Dr. Mashelkar, please.
Yes, thank you very much. First of all, very, very warm congratulations, hearty congratulations to Senthil, to Mudit. You have not only touched people's lives, but also touched our hearts today, everyone who is watching. Like you said at the end, the emerging digital India will have to go for digital health agenda. And these innovations are a perfect fit. Indeed, I would say exemplars. You know, recently I had the privilege of looking at a fascinating book that Ganesh and Uma Natarajan are writing, and this is about digital re-engineering for business transformation. I would say that what Senthil and Mudit have done is digital re-engineering for social transformation. Our award is very special, I want to remind you, because we just don't recognize, like we did today, hand over a cash prize, which is a very small amount of 1 lakh, give a trophy. These are all symbols. We applaud, like we did today, click photos like we are doing, and stop. No, that is where we actually begin. We go above and beyond by opening the doors of opportunity for the awardees, as you would see over the last 10 years, for funding, for mentorship, for partnerships, etc. We all have to support inclusive innovators, not just with venture funds, but also adventure funds, with soft funds. And it's not just the private sector that has a role to play here. In fact, the government can become the largest customer for inclusive innovations via progressive and promotional public procurement policies, 5 P's, if you like, that will ultimately result in the welfare of the masses. You can just see these two technologies, what difference it can make to India. For real inclusive growth, we all need to be partners in this. I would say, I used to say, I in India must stand for innovation. I would say, I in India must stand for inclusive innovation for attaining the inclusive growth. I want to thank you all for joining us in this journey, in this very, very humble contribution that we are trying to make in launching and taking forward this inclusive innovation movement for India. Thank you very much.
Thank you very much. And those were two quite innovative ideas and products. Now I would like to welcome our Associate Director, Mr. Abhay Vaidya. Sir, can you hear me?
Yeah, sure.
Yeah. So over to you, sir.
Thank you.
Friends, we have had a wonderful start to the 8th National Conference on Social Innovation, and I want to present an overview of this year's conference and also introduce and welcome our chief guest, Sri Srikant Vaidya. When we think of social inclusive innovations, C.K. Prahlad and the bottom of the pyramid come instantly to mind. Indeed, Pune has emerged as one of the important hubs of social innovation in the country, and this collaborative effort between the Pune International Center, Tata Institute of Social Sciences, and the National Innovation Foundation has contributed in a significant way. Every year, we receive a large number of applications from social innovators across the country, and this year too, we received more than 100 applications from diverse fields, ranging from agriculture to healthcare, education, community empowerment, vulnerable groups, and many more. From these, 18 innovators were selected in three categories: tribal, rural, and urban. These social innovators will be presenting their innovations in detail later today and tomorrow. During these 2 days, we will have three sessions on tribal, rural, and urban innovations. The tribal session will be chaired by Dr. Kiran Kulkarni, Director of Urban Development, Government of Maharashtra. The rural session will be chaired by Mr. Prakash Apte, Chairman Kotak Mahindra Bank. And the urban session will be chaired by Dr. Vipin Kumar, Director, National Innovation Foundation. I would now like to introduce our chief guest for the conference, Sri Srikant Vaidya, Chairman, Indian Oil Corporation. Welcome, sir. Mr. Srikant Madhav Vaidya heads the Fortune 500 energy company India Oil Corporation, which is India's largest oil refinery and fuel retailer. He has been with Indian Oil for nearly 34 years now. Mr. Vaidya is among the select technocrats in the oil and gas industry and is proficient in the full gamut of refinery petrochemicals integration, which is the future format for the downstream business. During his decade-long association with the world-class Panipat Naphtha cracker complex, he was involved right from drawing board stage to the commissioning and turnaround. A champion of clean and green fuels, Mr. Vaidya spearheaded the rollout of the Bharat Stage 6 transport fuels at Indian Oil well within the mandated timeline of April 1, 2020. The leapfrogging from BS4 to BS6 fuel within operating refineries and ensuring its reach to 27,500 IOC fuel stations was indeed a stellar feat. Another high point under his watch was the quick formulation of BS6 fuel for high altitude Himalayan region. Indian Oil, under Mr. Vaidya's leadership, is looking at fortifying its core strengths while adding greener energy offerings, including renewables. Demonstrating sensitivity to the environment, Mr. Vaidya, as the refinery head of Mathura Refinery, pioneered the use of treated refinery effluent for 100% industrial use for conserving fresh river water. His additional responsibilities include the non-executive chairmanship of Chennai Petroleum Corporation, a subsidiary of Indian Oil, and leadership roles in some other companies. May I now request Mr. Vaidya to kindly deliver his keynote address. Welcome, sir.
So we are just getting him in. He's logged in. Just a few seconds.
Hello.
Yes, sir. We can hear you. Okay. You can switch on your cameras.
Yeah, camera is switched on.
Yeah. Yes, sir. Thank you so much. Welcome.
Right, thank you.
We look forward to your keynote address.
Okay, fine. Dr. R. A. Mashelkar, President PIC, Dr. Vijay Kelkar, Vice President PIC, esteemed guests, and the brilliant group of social innovators who have joined us virtually for this webinar. Ladies and gentlemen, A very good evening to you all. I'm happy to be here today amongst you on this virtual platform that focuses on entrepreneurship and innovation, the forces that drive economic and social development. India today has reached that stage of the demographic transition wherein more than 60% of the population is in the economically active age group of 15 to 59 years, commonly referred to as the demographic dividend. For India to tap this dividend, it is necessary that the economy is able to generate enough job opportunities to productively absorb this economically active population. We do keep mentioning of 500 million strong workforce by 2022, but India faces challenges in reaping this demographic dividend, considering that illiteracy levels among the labor force is still very high, and is between 70 to 80% of the labor force have education levels below secondary. Almost 48% of the workforce is engaged in agriculture, while contribution of agriculture to GDP is not more than 16%. Entrepreneurship is not new to India. In fact, to quote from the Indian Industrial Commission report of 1916 to 1918, at a time when the world west of Europe, the birthplace of modern industrial system, was inhabited by uncivilized tribes, India was famous for the wealth of her rulers and for the high artistic skills of her craftsmen. And even at a much later period, when the merchant adventurers from the West made their first appearance in India, the industrial development of this country was, at any rate, not inferior to that of the most advanced European nations. In fact, an earlier version of the current Atmanirbhar Bharat was the Swadeshi movement launched in 1905 during the pre-independence era to boycott British-made goods and use Indian-made goods. The movement saw the development of the Indian textile industry, the iron and steel industry by the Tatas, publishing of vernacular newspapers, setting up of vernacular medium educational institutions, financial institutions, etc. However, post-independence, the policy focused on increased public investments in heavy industries did not provide an ideal environment for entrepreneurship. The main problems faced by an entrepreneur were lack of mentoring facilities, technology support, or easy availability of credit. The government has over time implemented policies for the promotion of the small industries, which included providing concessional credit, training into entrepreneurship development, marketing assistance, etc. But the entrepreneurial growth did not take off in a big way in India as compared to the other countries because of the procedural hassles, stringent labor laws, economic regulations, etc., that the establishments had to face. New economic changes will provide more opportunities, but not enough jobs. Therefore, one has to take advantage of the opportunities. Both in the urban and rural areas, there may not be an impressive rise in wage employment, but there will probably be enough scope for self-employment. The emphasis, therefore, has to be not on wage jobs, but on creating self-employed persons or entrepreneurs. The entire system of training and education will have to give emphasis on the development of entrepreneurship. The convergence of technology, integration across diverse fields, distributed architecture, and people willing to back an idea have opened a new world for enterprise. I see startups, technology, and innovation as exciting and effective instruments for India's transformation and for creating jobs for our youth. For startups today, there are different levels of financial support that has come to provide the initial seed capital in the form of incubators, angel funds, or venture capital funds, followed by private equity and debt in that order. I represent the Indian petroleum and natural gas industry, and this sector has witnessed one of the world's most extensive socio-economic reform programs. Today, the energy agenda in India is inclusive, market-based, and climate-sensitive. To meet the rapid growth of our energy needs, we have been working on a mission mode. India, like several other countries, is in the midst of energy transition. There will be a continuity of energy consumption pattern, but also a profound change as we integrate renewables more intensely in our energy mix. A case to cite is the policy thrust on biofuels in India that comes with a multitude of advantages from the point of view of environment and energy security and rural economic prosperity. And biofuels are expected to partake some part of the oil demand growth. India views compressed biogas or bio-CNG as a game changer that can address multiple energy objectives and is integral to our 15% natural gas penetration target by the year 2030. Biogas is being pursued in a big way through the SATAT, that is the Sustainable Alternative Towards Affordable Transportation, an initiative by the Ministry of Petroleum and Natural Gas. India targets producing 15 million metric tons of CBG by 2023 from 5,000 plants through the SATAT program. Under the SATAT scheme, Indian Oil has awarded 325 letters of intent to entrepreneurs for production and supply of 0.8 million metric tons of CBG. Indian Oil has already commissioned marketing of CBG from a few retail outlets located at Pune and Kolhapur. While a lot has been talked about the progress laid by entrepreneurs and venture capitalists in the private sector, it is vital to dispel the myth that the public sector will be less innovative. In fact, a quick look at the pioneering technologies, the space missions, for instance, points to the government and not the private sector as the most decisive player in the innovation game. Now, efforts are on in the public sector, which has slipped in the last few decades, to be future ready and globally competitive. I strongly believe that unless the PSU embraces innovation, they cannot survive. The public sector today represents an opportunity like never before, with the central and state governments keen on easing bottlenecks and exploring new frontiers in technology for future needs. One such example at Indian Oil is the acquisition of equity stake in an Israeli-based startup specializing in aluminum air battery systems for automobiles by IOC Sweden, a wholly owned subsidiary of Indian Oil, to develop and customize metal air batteries, which can significantly reduce dependence on lithium-ion components for mobility application. Another example, which I can readily recollect, is the battery swapping stations, which Indian Oil had installed at around 17 of our retail outlets located pan-India. I would also like to touch upon the startup fund launched by 10 oil PSUs with an initial corpus fund of 320 crores. The fund is being used to foster and nurture and incubate new ideas from startups and entrepreneurs. The fund supports startups or entrepreneurs serving in areas such as energy, waste to energy, renewables, health and hygiene, environment and safety, IoT, agriculture, education, women empowerment, rural development, skill development, project management, and other areas of high social impact. Indian Oil has also been working towards nurturing and supporting innovative ideas of our startup ecosystem. Indian Oil is launching the Indian Oil Startup Scheme in 2016 to promote innovation ecosystem and promising startups. IOCL Startup Scheme is unique in the sense that it is age and education agnostic and a thoroughly hands-on modus operandi for execution. Each identified and onboarded idea selected is assigned an IOCL scientist executive as internal process owner who acts as mentor and guide throughout the period of incubation. All the selected ideas are grouped into two broad categories: technology process reengineering and business process reengineering, mostly business innovation related to aim to develop software and digital aids. The National Research Center Corporation, NRDC, a PSU of DSIR under the Ministry of Science and Technology, is retained to administer the scheme in terms of follow-up and neutral validation of progress of the ideas for release of funds. So far, a total of 24 projects have been onboarded, spanning two rounds with a committed fund value of 44 crores. Of these, seven projects have reached proof of concept stage and ready for commercialization. The valuation of the completed project by an external agency ranges from 28 crores to rupees 216 crores. The IPRs generated so far are 33 joint patents and 6 copyrights. Two of these projects, one on eco toilets and the other on smart fuel management, were further awarded wide-scale trial by Indian Oil Marketing Division. After successful round 1 and 2 of Indian Oil startup initiatives, IOCL board has accorded approval for round 3 of the startup scheme. While speaking on energy transition, we at IOCL are also assessing multiple hydrogen pathways based on indigenously available resources, including biomass, sustainability of the production processes, and development of indigenous fuel cell stack technology. Hydrogen is a solution to the sustainable and secure energy future and is gaining much momentum globally. At IOCL, our R&D center is pursuing research in this area and focused on making significant contribution in developing the hydrogen economy infrastructure in the country. Hydrogen CNG production is one of the patented technologies of IOCL, with controlled steam reforming of natural gas to produce desired level of hydrogen in the outlet stream. Research has indicated that hydrogen level in the range of 18% in hydrogen CNG has several advantages, including improved combustion characteristics, reduced tailpipe emissions, and fuel economy over the conventional CNG. You must be well aware that 50 CNG buses are plying in Delhi since October 20 on 18% HCNG as a part of a wide-scale field trials aimed to reduce the urban air pollution in Delhi. The project is also being monitored by the Honorable Supreme Court of India. Successful validation of this concept will pave the way for ushering in hydrogen economy in the country. In one of the major initiatives to usher in the hydrogen economy in the country, IOCL is attempting to test the entire value chain of using hydrogen as fuel for mobility segment. Production, storage, compression, dispensing, and usage in fuel cell buses. Accordingly, IOCL is in the process of setting up of the demonstration plant for hydrogen production based on 4 different technologies at its R&D campus in Faridabad. The cumulative hydrogen generation capacity of these plants will be 1 ton per day of fuel cell grade quality. Further, under this project, 15 fuel cell buses will be procured by IOCL, aimed towards having the indigenous stack technology. These buses will be subjected to trials in Delhi NCR region for mileage accumulation to understand the performance efficacy and durability of the fuel cell technology. The project has also garnered the partial financial support from the Hydrogen Corpus Fund under the Ministry of Petroleum and Natural Gas. IOCL is also in the process of leveraging the surplus hydrogen capacities available at our refineries as one of the potential sources for promoting the fuel cell mobility. As part of this initiative, we are creating augmenting hydrogen infrastructure in the refineries to refuel fuel cell buses plying to the iconic routes and sites of heritage. One such route identified among others is from Baroda Refinery to the Statue of Unity in Gujarat. The buses will be operated in collaboration with the stack and powertrain technology supplier. The hydrogen from the refineries will be hyphenated with carbon capture and utilization technology to produce blue hydrogen during the course of the project. This is going to be the first commercial attempt of its kind in India. IOCL is also having a robust IP ecosystem with a healthy filing rate of 1,244 patents filed till date, including 231 US patents. The total active patent portfolio stands at 1,102 patents, which is the highest among the oil and gas PSU companies in India. Out of these 1,102 patents, 345 are Indian patents and 757 patents are foreign patents. IOCL has now commercialized 81 patent families and is maintaining a healthy commercialization rate of 8%, which is higher than the global average of 5%. We have an active corporate IP cell housed at our R&D center, which streamlines these patenting activities of all divisions of Indian Oil. A patent reward scheme giving monetary incentives to innovators on filing, grant, and commercialization is in operation since 2013. I'm very happy to announce that Indian Oil has been adjudged consecutively for 2 years in 19 and 20 as the top Indian IP wealth creator in the corporation's chemical and energy category by Clarivate, an independent IP analytics agency. The oil and energy sector is inextricably linked to the inspirational drive towards Atmanirbhar Bharat. With decentralized energy solutions in rooftop solar and compressed biogas, under the Satat initiative, IOCL is already gearing up to steer India's entrepreneurial growth by creating an enabling environment supported by technical facilitation and market linkage. Now I would like to touch upon the Pradhan Mantri Ujjwala Yojana. This program has empowered women from below the poverty line category by introducing them by exposing them to food. Has seen in the recent past. Go to the end. The scheme has seen a significant social movement and has benefited 8 crore households in the country and has transformed the social economic dynamics in the favor of the rural women. The Pan India rollout would not have been possible but for the digitalization of business processes with Indian Oil adoption of latest technologies driven processes was considered as a fancy investment afforded only by a few players until a few years ago. With that, I would like to hear Dr. Mashelkar and all the other stakeholders so that we are able to get a feel of how the youth is feeling about these new initiatives that the country and more so what IOCL is taking in the energy sector. Thank you very much. So thank you very much. I would like to now hear Dr. Mashelkar and all the other entrepreneurs on what they are actually feeling on these initiatives, what we as the oil industry are taking, and what more can be done to make these schemes and our startup in ecosystem much more effective. Thank you very much.
Thank you. Thank you very much. This was very, very inspiring. It is very clear that our future will be safe only with green growth. The two words have to go together. If it is not green, then it is not sustainable growth at all. And therefore, renewables is the key. And within that, hydrogen economy, and not just hydrogen economy, the green hydrogen economy is going to be the key. All right. And coupling it with solar, wind, and an integrated look at that is going to be critical. You know, I have my friend Alan Finkel, who is the chief scientist of Australia, and he has been driving the green hydrogen economy initiative in Australia. And I will send you some of the sort of details he has sent on how they are systematically moving towards that.
Okay.
They're actually going to export hydrogen to countries like Japan, so as to see. And build hydrogen economy on the basis of that. I think it is the same thing that is possible here. As you know, I'm on the Reliance board.
Yeah.
And Mukesh Bhai has been talking about being the largest and the cheapest producer of hydrogen in the world. And setting, as usual, you know, as he sets targets, $1 per kilogram, which is looking impossible, but we have done impossible looking things possible between IOC, between etc. So millions of tons of these can be actually produced. So I'm all sold on that. There is no question about that.
Right.
And we'll require not just renovation, we'll require innovation.
Yes.
And we'll not require just incremental innovation, we'll require disruptive innovation. We require newer ways of doing things. And there I must say, the startup ecosystem is going to play a very critical role. Because previously we thought, and I've been very closely associated with IOC R&D, I'm a great admirer of IOC. What you have been able to achieve is phenomenal, you know. And we always thought that we'll do it within, so as to say. But the new force that is coming up now is the young India, the startup India, you know. And it is amazing. We had a chance to look at what's happening around the world in terms of the new breakthroughs that are actually coming up. And it is absolutely incredible. So in looking at them, looking at startups as access to talent and technology is going to be very critical for us. So I think not only we are on the right path, that's the only path that we can take, and we can show the leadership. So we are very grateful to you for joining us and inspiring us with this great vision of radical transformation through this sustainable, inclusive growth, the green growth. Thank you.
Thank you, sir.
Mr. Chairman, if you permit, I want to add a few words.
Yeah, please do.
No, but of course, I want to congratulate Chairman IOC for the presentation of what I was doing. And frankly, listening to him, I feel like Rip Van Winkle, because I was associated with that great organization 25 years ago. And he really outlined how far advanced they have become over the last 25 years and maintained the leadership of technology. And I really want to convey my deep appreciation of IOC's entrepreneurship, technological entrepreneurship. And I'm sure that even in the area of venture capital, venture enterprises, supporting enterprises, IOC again will be sort of trailblazer. I think one area I would suggest for his consideration, but look at the whole issue of all these issues. I mean, on the sort of production side of energy, but also the consumption side, whether we can increase the efficiency of your customers, because you may have to do a lot of education of your customers for using energy far more efficiently and using. So that's one area in which you may have to hold their hands, because you have technological promises which they don't have. And lastly, taking this opportunity also, I hope that you agreed to, the enthusiasm which you agreed to give that keynote address. And I hope you will be continue to be associated with this movement of social innovation, support social innovation. Thank you.
Thank you, sir. Can you hear me? Yeah.
Yeah.
Yes. Thank you very much. And it was very inspiring from the thought leaders. We would now like to have interaction with all our innovators. Before that, I'll quickly read out the citation of all the 18 finalists that we have participating in this NCSI. I'll request my team to display the slides. So in the tribal category, we have Dakti Craft, works in the arts and craft sector. The look to conserve nature by preserving traditional knowledge and skills. Then we have Shramik Janta Vikas Sanstha. Founder is Adinath Ombale. Is working for tribal and marginal community empowerment through natural resources, livelihood enhancement. We have Sai Krishna, founder of Fishy Farmers Private Limited, addresses the issue of water scarcity through aquaponics. Atso Chases, who is the founder of GIE, is working on traditional instruments to upgrade them to contemporary and make them more friendly. Nitesh Bharajwat, founder of Ulgrun Foundation, is working to create social awareness and raising local issues by using mobile films in tribal areas of Maharashtra. This is the tribal category. We move to a rural category now. We have Smriti Gupta, founder of Where Are India's Children? They're working on building sustainable solutions to move abandoned and orphaned children towards a positive outcome, including the legal adoption pool. Akshay Dixit is the founder of Vestago. It's a platform providing efficient and economical logistic opportunities to farmers and ensuring optimal utility of resources. Surendra Yadav is a founder of Self-Reliant India, prepares government kits for Jawahar Navodaya Vidyalaya entrance test and is currently working in Haryana. We have Kalyani Shinde, who is the founder of Godam Innovations, works in the agri-tech space, specifically in onion warehousing to convert traditional warehouses to smart warehouses as to reduce wastage. Prathamesh Kant, founder of Agoiz Business Solutions, is an agri-tech space, specifically in agri-fintech startup working on agenda of financial inclusions and digitizations, currently focused on providing post-harvest receivable financing to farmers. And lastly, in rural category, we have Ayush Nigam, founder of Distinct Horizon. He's innovating agricultural machinery that can double the profits of farmers and reduce GHG emissions in 5 times lesser cost than solar panels and half the time. Then we are moving to urban category. We have Shashank Nimkar, who is the founder of Earth Tattva, works to reduce mining for natural resources by making products from recycled ceramics under closed loop zero waste manufacturing process. Sonal Kane is the founder of Quirk Lab. She has invented a book sharing platform called Flip, where children can read, share, and review books. Swapnil Joshi, founder of EcoRegan Solutions Private Limited, is a brand that accepts your old clothes to recycle and upcycle them into unique, sustainable, and fashionable items. The fourth category, founder social innovator is Purav Desai, founder of Recube Circular Solutions Private Limited. Creates reusable packaging systems out of crop waste to enable a circular economy. They set up a unique segregation and refill system as well to ensure zero waste system. Then we have Shashank Gupta, founder of Gnome. Gnome is a sustainable food tech enterprise building full stack sustainable solutions. Deepak VS is a founder of Tilt. Tilt is India's only B2B bike sharing platform. They work closely with campuses to make customized bike sharing solutions. I thank our guest to be with us and interact with all these 18 social innovators. They are here with us. So I'll open the interaction with all these social innovators along with Dr. Mashirkar, sir.
Yeah, sure. Both of us, Shrikantji as well as
yes, Shrikantji and yourself.
Yeah, I'm here.
sure.
But sir, with you around, nobody's going to ask me a question.
Yes. So first of all, congratulations to all of you. I think it's music to my ears tribal, rural, urban, in each case, you know, these words like sharing economy, circular economy are big words, but actually you are practicing it. As I was listening to what you are doing, that's amazing. I mean, for example, creating wealth from waste, you know, is a theme that we have been trying to pursue. And this is something you are already doing. What I'm also impressed to see is you're trying to bring the digital part in. And we have to do that because Digital India is not a dream. It is actually happening. You know, we are moving very, very rapidly. As you remember, I mean, I remember, Shikharji, you are too young. When I came back to India in 1976, and I think for young people, it will be an amusement. It took me 6 years to get a landline. Every 6 seconds, a mobile is sold today. All right. So the world has changed very dramatically. I remember we had to book a trunk call for a couple of days. We used to wait and we used to shout so much that even in England, one could hear what we are saying. From that, all of you are empowered. So taking that digital technology basically to rural villages is very important. And you heard the Anjani Mashelkar Inclusive Innovation Awards, how they are using it, like pregnant women in distant villages using IoT, basically where their health is tracked practically every minute, is incredible, something that you would not have thought about.
Yeah.
And therefore, this digital is not just high-tech. You know, they say making high technology work for the rich is very easy. Making low technology work for the poor is very easy, but making high technology work for the poor is a challenge, all right? And I think there is an enormous scope. So I was very happy to hear about what you are doing, including, let's say, the logistics for farmers and the whole range of other things that we are doing. Also, this sort of book sharing, children reviewing books, I think that's fantastic, you know, getting them involved in an intellectual activity like this actually become possible. In fact, the digital world makes it possible to do so many things which are not realized. You know, we are cursing the current pandemic for the devastation it has caused, but at the same time, it has given us an awareness about the power of the digital world to create an inclusive India of a kind that we never before thought about. So I want to congratulate all of you here. I can't take all the individual names that were basically read out, but we are extremely proud of you. And social innovation is the key. Finally, we have to create an inclusive India. And as I said in my opening remarks, everyone is someone, and minds on the margin are not necessarily marginal minds. So all of us can think, all of us can create ideas to make a difference and create social transformation. So we not only congratulate you, we thank you for being what you are and what you have done for the society.
Yeah, sir, I would like to take the opportunity, since you mentioned about waste to wealth. I mean, here the Satat scheme has got an enormous potential to change the face of the rural India. It can give employment to the rural India. It can create a lot of gas infrastructure, which the country really needs. So I appeal to all the entrepreneurs, because we have got such an ambitious target and the oil companies are really helping them out. They have got an offtake guarantee of whatever gas is being produced. Our R&D also has got technology in case somebody needs it. So I think if young people come forward and put up, small plants all over the country, I mean, it will really change the face of the urban rural India. It will take care of the agricultural waste, which is really a big problem in the country. Plus, it will give a lot of value to the product. So I think all the young people who are listening to me, I think they should come out in a big way. And the whole ecosystem is there to help them.
Yeah. I think that's an extraordinary point, because we talk about development, but we have to talk about what Shikhanji just now mentioned, about development that is distributed, that is not centralized. And therefore, even biogas that we talk about or hydrogen generation locally. You know, Srikanth, you may be knowing Ravi Pandit of KPIT Technologies, for example. And he has a terrific project where he has this idea of decentralized development in terms of decentralized generation of hydrogen. And there is both a catalytic as well as a non-catalytic process to generate hydrogen locally. Now, what difference it can make? Because you know the problems of transport of hydrogen. Hydrogen is a very light gas, and therefore to transport it is very expensive. And again, there is a sort of a problem of compression, recompression, and energy losses and so on. But now you can see if you are distributing it basically locally, all right, and that can be used in local trucks, local buses, so that the so I think India has to look at this decentralized development, which was implicit in Gandhiji's sort of original sort of thinking.
Yes.
Remember, he used to say issue of production and trade and consumption has to be localized. I think we can create a new hydrogen economy, which is a big one on other one hand, like you are Reliance doing with their whole big infrastructure, but at the same time, decentralized one. And that is where local innovation is required. Yes. So I totally support your point.
Sir, and you'll be happy to know that we are in touch with Mr. Pandey. In mm-hmm. fact, we are going to sign an MOU also with him. And whatever the hydrogen powered buses, which we are going to run from Baroda refinery to Statue of Unity, he will be a part of that project.
Absolutely. And both Vijay Kelkar and I have been sort of associated with him in terms of sort of supporting him in this very ambitious exponential project yes. that he has. It's really a dream that can make a difference to India. India requires different models.
Yes. We need a customized model for ourselves.
Yeah, exactly. We can't just follow the West.
Exactly, yes.
So we have our innovators here. I just missed out on introducing one of our innovators, Mr. Santosh Fad. ThinkSharp Foundation is a not-for-profit social enterprise working to improve quality of education in rural schools. Santosh is here. So thank you for your very insightful and inspiring thoughts. And these innovators, if they have any questions during this interaction, please do ask questions to Dr. Mashilkar sir or our guest, Mr. Vaidya. Any questions with you? You can unmute yourself and ask if you have any questions. Santosh?
Yeah. So I don't have a specific question, but I really appreciate Dr. Mashilkar sir and Mr. Vaidya for giving so much insight, your thoughts, because many times we need some push from behind. And I think you, entire ecosystem, you have created through various innovative platforms. And I think that is what we require, because we are ready to take this country to the next step. But we need some support and some motivation. And I think that is there. And I once again thank you and congratulate you for whatever that you have created so far. So thank you very much, sir.
Thank you. Thank you so much. Thank you so much.
Thank you, everybody. I hope there are no questions, and it is such a, we are so glad that we have two eminent personalities here interacting with you. So moving on to the next session of tribal innovators showcasing their or presenting their innovations. We have with us Dr. Kiran Kulkarni, who is the Director of Urban Development. Welcome, Doctor. You are on mute, sir.
Yes. Thank you, Manda.
Yeah. So we will now have recorded presentations of our six tribal innovators. Starting now, I'll request my team to start the presentation, starting with Dakti Craft. And we have our jury as well, in this panel who will be judging these innovators. And I would request Mr. Vaidya to be there to listen to these very innovating stories and products that these innovators have brought.
I'll be there till the end, don't worry.
Thank you so much, sir. So I'll request Dr. Kiran Kulkarni to take it from here.
Sure, thank you, Manda. Namaste to all dignitaries on the screen, off the screen, and behind the screen. First of all, I express my gratitude towards Pune International Center for giving me an opportunity to chair tribal innovation session. All of you know that tribal population is considered as disadvantageous group economically. However, culturally, I should mention here, culturally, they are most advanced and so-called mainstream society can learn a lot from them. Tribal population is sizable in our country, particularly in central region of India. For example, in Maharashtra, tribal population constitutes approximately 9% of state population. 9% share of Maharashtra state budget is allotted to tribal development, which comes to around 8,000 to 9,000 crores annually. In other states also, such budget allocation is done. There is need of innovative ideas, innovative mechanisms, and proper implementation of various governmental and non-governmental initiatives for tribal population. I find today's session very important in this context. I welcome all the presenting innovators and members of jury panel. I request first presenter, Dutty Kraft, Rida Gadpop, Peter Marbinang, and Gopal Krishnan to present. Over to Dutty Kraft.
So hello everyone, this is Rida Gadpop. We are from Dutty. We are a social enterprise based in Meghalaya. I did my graduation from NIST, and when I came back from Mumbai, I was working in Mumbai for many years, and then when I came back in 2007, that's when I realized that this was an awesome opportunity and met Peter during the journey in 2010, and that's when we started.
Hi, I'm Peter. I finished economics from NID in Ahmedabad and came back here. So, you know, on Sterling, we were drawn in by the rich culture, frustration, skills, the resources available here in our state. But what we found was lacking was the opportunity. So, and hence began this journey of Sakti. I would like now to ask Gopal if he can take this forward.
Hello everyone, my name is Gopal. I'm based in Mumbai and I'm one of the team members of Dutty Kraft. So let me start with a brief introduction about Dutty. The idea came about when we wanted to give humane solutions to human problems. And we wanted to sort of bring about this in the textile and handicraft sector. And going forward, we also want to expand into the food and agriculture sector. We are a for-profit social enterprise with a core team of three, and artisans, we have about 30 plus right now, and a full-time staff of 10 people. Currently, we are in the first phase of our operation. Our vision really has been to conserve nature and preserve traditional knowledge and skills. And that's why our mission was to sort of create an enterprise that is relevant for today and ready for tomorrow. And that's a big lesson we've also sort of learned with the pandemic right now. Our offerings are all about anything that's available naturally, made locally, sourced responsibly, crafted manually, and produced seasonally. And the real USP of what we offer is that they are 100% handcrafted, organic, healthy, slow, and seasonal. Here are a few examples of the kind of work we do, the different clusters. Both Rida and Peter are very hands-on in the work they do. They travel a lot, interact with the craft clusters, mainly the pottery cluster in Jaintia Hills and the bamboo and cane cluster in East Khasi Hills. And if you notice, most of them are the women craftsmen that we're working with right now. So the opportunity really, where we saw the opportunities were sort of when identifying the problems and bringing about solutions for these. The biggest problem we found was the human attitude to consume more and value less. So that we said, let's try and address that by helping the consumer feel the real worth of any product that he buys and actually feel the value that it brings to his life. The second thing was the lack of history, emotions, and craftsmanship attached to the products that are actually flooding the market right now. And this we wanted to address by going to the grassroots level and making the artisan himself aware of the importance of the knowledge and the tradition that he's carrying forward and making sure that it reflects in his work. And the third thing was about the fact that the handmade products today, if you notice, is losing its relevance in the modern lifestyle. So it was really important for us to come up with a brand and make sure that it reflects the needs and the personalities of today's consumer. And the markets we identified for this were the readily available markets like the handmade, eco-friendly, green fashion, organic produce, and the slow food markets. These are our focus areas now. The consumers we're really talking to are the ones who are very ethical in what they're looking for, especially when it comes to the rarity, the purity, the simplicity, the originality, and functionality of the products that they want to pick up. As far as competition is concerned, we are a very well-protected niche and with a very defined clientele, actually. And these are the kind of services that we offer cannot be met by bigger companies. Here are some examples of what we do. The black clay pottery range, we have a cookware and tableware range. We've also delved into fashion accessories using bamboo and cane. And we also do furniture with bamboo. These are the examples. A few of the examples, actually. As far as our approach for the next 2 years is concerned, we want to take one craft at a time because there are so many crafts to explore in Meghalaya. Our focus really over the next 2 years is going to be to set up the black clay pottery range as a main product line. We want to expand our current catalog, which is beyond and go beyond tableware and cookware because we've seen a lot more possibilities, especially with the feedback we're getting from people. And the third agenda is to build a team, like, you know, to start to handle it from start to end when it comes to production, operations, and distribution, so that it allows us to go to the next craft. We don't want to leave it halfway. And another agenda is to think long term in what we do. So that's why we want to invest more on the human skills. Our focus is really going to be on organic materials, and we really want to embrace clean energy. And these are our long term goals. As far as sales and distribution is concerned, our direct orders are the private orders that we get, corporate orders and commission projects, which have been keeping us busy. As far as the markets, the domestic retail markets, we want to expand beyond the four boutique stores that we are actually catering to right now. Again, we've just touched upon two or three cities as of now. We want to grow beyond that. And the export market, we really want to tap in because that's where the real demand lies for the kind of products we have in our catalog at this point. And also because our last year's revenue, about 80% has come out from, especially from the export market. So we see huge potential there and we want to focus on that. And the most important thing is setting up our online business because again, from the pandemic, we've learned that we need to be online, we need to be present, and we need to be available where the consumers are. As far as a strategy, we wanted a brand and a perception for a brand to be green from the go and not just a tag that's attached to our label or something like that. And we want to live by example. And that's why we've set up these very strong principles for ourselves, like no hurry, our production is seasonal and we work around nature's patterns. No worry because everything we require is around us. All our raw materials are sourced locally. No more because we make a very limited range of every collection so that we can live in harmony with nature. No other since our products are all handmade. They're very unique one from the other. No frills because we believe in simplicity in everything that we do, including our packaging and publicity. No big deal, yes, because we believe that everything comes at a cost and one should pay a fair price for it. Again, if you see the financials, just a brief run through is we've been growing gradually and especially last year's seen a spike because of our entry into the export market. Here is an example of the common facilitation center we've been building over the last 2-3 years. And we're now ready to go with operations there. We've been recognized by the Telegraph and the National Entrepreneurship Award we won this year for most of the efforts we've done over the last 10 years. And this is the way we are actually contributing to conserving nature and preserving tradition by really taking a holistic approach by diversifying ourselves into arts, crafts, food, and music. And here is where you actually, all of you can come and join, be part of our journey to create a positive impact. The various ways to support us is we want to embrace clean energy. So we're looking at technology partners to implement renewable energy systems. As far as creating livelihood, we are encouraging more corporates to come in and give us orders. We're looking at sponsorships for our events and workshops that we do across India and even locally. We are looking for partners and collaborators when it comes to the intervention programs that we're doing within the clusters, engaging craftsmen. As far as scaling up is concerned, yes, a lot of it depends on the funding. We are also looking at consultancy in terms of business, running the business and how we can actually expand and grow. And R&D has been a very important part of the process of our growth. So especially because most of the areas we're dealing with have very less research and development already done, especially an example I can give you is the pineapple fiber and other materials like that. And one of the biggest areas we want support is to set up our online store and people to manage the social media presence, because that's eventually going to be the way for us to reach out to our customers. So yes, please come join the journey, and there are many ways we can work towards creating a positive impact together. Thank you. I'd like to end it there.
It was wonderful. Thank you, Dr. Krapti. Now I will invite next presenter, social innovator, Fishy Farmers, Mr. Sai Krishna.
Hi, this is Sai Krishna, founder and CEO of Fishy Farmers Private Limited. The problem we are addressing is water scarcity. More than 60% of our agriculture depends on rain, and unfortunately 42% of India is under drought, and 500 million people are severely affected. Luckily, because of the 2020 rains, this problem doesn't seem very severe, but in the future, the water under the ground is only going to reduce. So the solution is to utilize this scarce water at its maximum potential. So for which we adopted aquaponics, a system in which we have fish growing at one end. The water from the fish system is then filtered and then passed on to the horticulture system, where the nutrients are absorbed by the plants, leaving the water fresh to return back to the system. Though the technology of aquaponics is quite old, the filtration system which we've designed has reduced the cost of the total system drastically. And with it, the closed loop system helps us achieve close to 90% of water efficiency and grow 6 times more when compared to traditional agricultural practices. The prototype of our system was established in outskirts of Hyderabad in this 320 square meters plot. The total capex which went into the system was close to about 9 lakhs, and the production we achieved from this existing system was 2 tons of fish production per annum and almost 5 tons of leafy greens per annum. The products which we sell from our fish system are fish, fish fillets, and value-added products such as fish pickles. And on the exotic leafy green side, we sell lettuce, baby spinach, basil, celery, parsley, pak choy, and Brussels sprouts. As a startup, we provide our technology to farmers, to FPOs and NGOs, also provide them with input materials, trainings to understand the system, and also provide regular audits so that the system is performing at its maximum efficiency. Giving the entire backhand support, we also support the farmers with a buyback guarantee of the fish and plants grown in their system. At present, we have our advanced aquaponics construction happening in Mulugu, around 50 kilometers from the city of Hyderabad. We are also assisting NFDB in building backyard RAS systems in Vikarabad, which is again a place in Telangana. Finally, we are also encouraging the urban dwellers to establish home systems near their homes to understand the process of aquaponics. Our initial market was targeted where retailers, supermarket, and e-commerce collection points. All these places had a continuous demand for exotic leafy greens, and there was a advantage of immediate payment and scalability in these markets. Finally, despite, as you can see, the cost of our product is much less than the existing market price, we are sustainable, we are locally grown, and most importantly, we are also organic. Finally, I ask for a investment of 25 lakhs to increase our present production capacity and also to reach more NGOs and FPOs for the cross implementation of the system. We have started our company in the year 2018 with a bootstrapping of 15 lakhs and within a year gained a seed fund investment of 25 lakhs from AIDEA Now. Way forward, with our existing system and technology, we would like to increase the overall production of fish and plants to close to about 100 tons each. And with our technology, we would like to penetrate much more into the rural India with the help of FPOs and NGOs and tie up with NFDB for the backyard projects and other NFDB Blue Revolution projects. Finally, the team comprises of myself, Sai Krishna, founder and CEO, Madhusudan Rao, the system designer for aquaponics, Santoshi, the sales and HR, Mallikarjunan, the branding and marketing guy. Finally, the greatest challenge we as humanity face is to feed the increasing population, and it is only possible with major transformation in agriculture, improvement in rural economies, and natural resource management. Thank you.
Thanks, Sai Krishna, for your
basic idea of fishy farmers came seeing the problems faced by farmers, especially related to water. Water is a major concern for India, and as per the United Nations report, by 2025, India might be drought struck. So our startup idea was to use water as efficiently as possible. With this system right now, you see 90% efficiency being achieved. The idea is you grow fish in one box. The water from the fish, which is nutrient rich, comes to another box, which gets filtered. And from there, the water goes into the boxes you see behind me, which helps the plants to grow. So one of the plants which we are growing is romaine lettuce. Okay, it's just 28 days old, and there's still time for it to grow. By doing this, we are saving almost 90% water at the same time growing both crops and fish in the same system.
Thanks, Sai Krishna, for your nice presentation. Now let me invite Gay Yu at Sochazi for next presentation.
Hi, everyone. My name is Atso Chase, and I'm the team leader of Gil Production. So it's an honor to be sharing my PPT today to the Pune International Center. So I'll begin with the problem. So here we have, in my first slide, I have the problem that is, with international art forms and numerous musical instruments readily available for mass usage, there is a neglect in the exploration of traditional artistic expression. And the second point I have here is that original traditional instruments have failed to attract or inspire the new generation of musicians due to its inflexibility in blending with the genres, different genres, with the evolution of music. I think there is a dire need for the evolution of its instrument as well. I will go on to the next slide. So here our team provides a solution as in GIO, the instrument, reenacts the cultural artistic forms and accepts the importance of cultural revolution. It provides more space to explore and can use with both traditional and contemporary tunes and art forms as well. That's a bonus. And the third point, it adheres to the demands of the evolution of music whilst keeping the traditional value alive. So GIO is a modified and upgraded instrument. It is versatile as well. I have here a picture of an old instrument, which is Tech Nabu traditional. And the next one in figure number two, we have developed GIO. I would like to demonstrate a short sound of it. So that's the sound, but it's very low in quality as well. And here. So that's the difference in sound and quality of the instrument that we have developed. The older one has very less sound in volume. It requires a lot of things that we cannot explore on the old instrument. Where the new instrument, we provide a solution with more strings, more scale arrange, and louder in sound. I'll be going to the next slide. Here we have the product and service. So Gyul, an upgraded traditional musical instrument of the Nagas with the capability to compete with the Western musical instruments. And number two, we have product will include professional level, beginner's level, miniature, decorative pieces as well to attract tourists, as well as people who are willing to explore this instrument as a hobby or as a professional level as well. So to attract tourists wishing to take souvenirs on their travel as well, we are also providing and then developing all these types of different categories. And the target market of our product will be musicians, music schools, and through performances and also through sharing and then through FM, as well as people interested to pursue music as a hobby as well, and tourists. Next is our team have the barriers. The main barriers include the many musical instruments readily available in the market, which will be a challenge as well for this given instrument to also play a similar role to musicians. And number two, we have lack of publicity at the moment, making it difficult to reach the right audience. And lack of funding and investors. Number four, we have help in promoting traditional musical instruments, which are on the verge of extinction. It represents a true cultural heritage, which is vital. So here, our team also has an appeal like, I think it is really important and necessary to be rooted on our culture as well, where art can truly represent us. It can be not just this instrument, but like the many instruments which are on the verge of extinction throughout India, throughout the world. I think it is really vital, and that I believe we can do something really great in here, like trying to promote, trying to uplift, and then also reconnect with our cultural values and our roots. I will go to the next one. Our unique selling proposition, I'll just read through this, is to target local folk musicians and use them as ambassadors for promotion, train more people on the instrument, and introduce them in music schools as well. The Gyul gives an opportunity to introduce a fresh sound in a band repertoire. So the Gyul will be cheaper, and also it has a unique sound, very versatile. So we have here the revenue model. We will be introducing it in music schools, mass production, selling, as well as teaching opportunities will be created. Souvenirs for tourists, procure raw materials directly from the rural areas, thereby benefiting people from the grassroots level as well. Our way forward is like eventually we'll be publishing an easy learning book, handbook of how to play the instrument Gyul and introduce them to music schools. We have our expectation from NCSI. It is it will be very helpful to get some fundings, as well as we are also really interested in the publicity and of the instrument of our production, and also helping promoting the instrument. And lastly, let me introduce my team members to you. So my name is Atocha Seb, and we are from the northeast part of India, Kohima, Nagaland. And here, I'm the inventor, Atocha Seb. And next, we have one of the luthiers, this is Nongsan Tudir. And next, we have Velakuso. He's a student, as well as he'll be teaching the Gyo instrument. Next, we have the promoter, Avi Leziner. He is the proprietor of Musician Studio Kohima, and we are collaborating through this project. We'll be introducing the instrument, the courses from his schools. And next, we have our marketing promoter. She is Nokonika. And lastly, our media partner, Tetsulo Naro. Thank you.
Thanks, Atso. A wonderful presentation. Now I will like to invite the next presenter, Shramik Janata Vikasa Samstha, Mr. Adinath Umble. Over to Adinath.
Welcome. Shramik Janata Vikasa Samstha, Satara se apna sarvon ka swagat hai. Shramik Janata Vikasa Samstha pichle 22 साल से 1995 में सतारा डिस्ट्रिक्ट में जावली तहसील के 22 गांवों में सोशल और आर्थिक विकास का काम कर रही है। पिछले 25 सालों से वंचित समाज और आर्थिक दुर्बल का जीवन स्तर बढ़ाने का प्रयास उपक्रमों द्वारा शुरू है। श्रमिक के फोकस उपक्रम आदिवासी विकास, महिला रूरल डेवलपमेंट और अल्पबुधा किसान संगठन और उनका विकास और शासन की जो योजना है उनकी जानकारी देना, यही श्रमिक का फोकस उपक्रम शुरू है। मेरा नाम आदिनाथ ओमले है और मैं पिछले 25 साल से इस संस्था की स्थापना करके मैं काम कर रहा हूँ। मैं छोटे किसान से मैं हूँ और यही एरिया में मैं रहता हूँ। इस एरिया के जो प्रॉब्लम्स है उसमें जो हमारे यहाँ जो ट्राइबल कम्युनिटी, स्पेशली कातकरी ट्राइब इन द सातारा डिस्ट्रिक्ट है और ये सातारा डिस्ट्रिक्ट में जो कातकरी कम्युनिटी है उनका जो मुख्य जो ये है इस कार्यक्षेत्र में करीबन 1300 फैमिली आजीविका फिशिंग और क्रैप पकड़ के उनको बेचते हैं और खेती के सीजन में मजदूरी करते हैं। खेती का काम खत्म होने के बाद कम काम मिलता है तो कहीं लोग जंगल से ये हानि निकलने का काम शुरू करते हैं। जब ये हानि निकलने का काम शुरू करते हैं तो ये मधुमक्खी को जलाते हैं और पूरी हनी कॉम निकलते हैं। इसके वजह से हनी बीज ये सीरिया से कम हो रहा, धीरे धीरे कम हो रहा है और माइग्रेंट भी हो रहा है और जंगल और खेती के ऊपर पॉलिनेशन और पर्यावरण ऊपर के भी हो रहा है। सरकार ने डैम के ऑक्शन इस एरिया में किया है तो मच्छी मारने चला जा रहा है। ये प्रॉब्लम छुड़ाने के लिए श्रमिक ने केंद्र सरकार की डिपार्टमेंट ऑफ साइंस एंड टेक्नोलॉजी से मदद ली है। इसमें एक इनोवेटिव किट डेवलप किया है। इसमें हनी निकलते समय एक ड्रेस पहनने के लिए बनाया है के वास्ते मधुमक्खी उनको काटती नहीं है। हनी साइंटिफिक मेथड से निकलने के लिए नाइफ का इस्तेमाल करके 75% की हनी निकलते, इसके वास्ते मधुमक्खी को ईजा नहीं पहुंचती। ऐसे 50 हनी हंटर को हमने चुन लिया है और उनको ये इस हनी का को प्रोसेसिंग के लिए हनी प्रोसेसिंग के ट्रेनिंग दिया है तो इनको एक डेवलप किया है। वो किट पहन के वो हनी निकलने के जाते हैं तो इनको कोई मधुमक्खी काटती नहीं है। दूसरा हनी हार्वेस्टिंग का टेक्निक डेवलप किया है। इसमें हनी हार्वेस्टिंग का टेक्निक डेवलप करके उसको ये हनी हार्वेस्टिंग का कोम निकलते समय 75% हनी निकलने का ट्रेनिंग दिया है और 25% उनको ले कैप्ट उधर ही रखना का हम कोशिश कर रहे हैं। तो इसका में हुआ है कि ये जो हनी प्रोसेसिंग से अब तक आदिवासी समाज के लिए आजीविका के लिए एक नया सोर्स उपलब्ध हो गया है, इसका परिणाम आदिवासियों को बहुत अच्छा एक नया बिजनेस मिल गया है। तो अब तक ये युवकों ने 2000 किलो हनी निकल कर प्रोसेसिंग किया है और आदिवासी समाज की आर्थिक परिस्थिति सुधारने के लिए प्रोसेस शुरू किया है। इसका यूनिक ऐसा है कि हनी जंगल से शुद्ध मिलती है और इससे कोई मिलावट नहीं हो रही है। ये हनी प्रोसेसिंग का यूनिट जब हमने शुरू करने का प्रयास किया, श्रमिक ने पहले बार कतकरी युवकों को चुना और इनको साइंटिफिक हनी कलेक्शन का ट्रेनिंग देने का काम शुरू किया। बहुत सारे इस मेथड से हनी निकलने के लिए राजी नहीं थे, इनको बार बार समझाने के बाद कोशिश करके हमें यह मेथड डेवलप किया और उनके ही हनी प्रोसेसिंग का यूनिट हमने शुरू किया। शुरू करते समय अभी इस हनी सेंटर में शुद्ध हनी आती है, जंगल से हनी आते हैं और कातकरी नाम से ही ये बेची जा रहा है। अब श्रमिक एनसीआई से ये यूनिट कातकरी युद्ध के सहभाग से ही चलाने के लिए ये युद्ध को ट्रेनिंग चाहती है। महाराष्ट्र में हनी हंटर लोगों का एक सर्वेक्षण और उनको साइंटिफिक मेथड से हनी निकालने का प्रशिक्षण देने का एनसीआई से मदद मिलनी चाहिए। आदिवासी कातकरी युवकों के लिए सोशल एंटरप्रेन्योरशिप प्रोग्राम बना के उनको मार्केटिंग और कैपिटल प्रोवाइड करने के लिए मदद चाहिए। मार्केटिंग और थेट ग्राहक सर्वेक्षण के लिए एनसीआई से मदद हम चाहते हैं। श्रमिक के इस कार्यक्षेत्र में महाबलेश्वर जैसा बड़े पहाड़ों का एरिया है और ये बड़े पहाड़ों में काफी हनी बीज निकलती है, तो बड़े पहाड़ों से ये हनी निकलने का नया टेक्निक डेवलप करने के लिए एनसीआई से हम मदद चाहते हैं। ऐसे बहुत नए नए तरीके ढूंढ सकते हैं, तो ये पर्यावरण और खेती और जंगल काम बहुत आसानी से हो जाएगा ऐसा मेरे को लग रहा है। और ये आपका सभी का धन्यवाद और थैंक यू।
थैंक्स आदिनाथ, आपका प्रेजेंटेशन बहुत अच्छा रहा। आई नाउ इनवाइट नेक्स्ट प्रेजेंटर इनोवेटर थिंक शार्प फाउंडेशन मिस्टर संतोष फड।
हेलो एवरीवन, माय नेम इज संतोष, आई एम फाउंडर एट थिंक शार्प फाउंडेशन। थिंक शार्प फाउंडेशन इज अ नॉन प्रॉफिट ऑर्गेनाइजेशन स्टार्टेड इन 2011 विद द विजन ट्रांसफॉर्मिंग ट्राइबल एंड रूरल गवर्नमेंट स्कूल्स एजुकेशन। So, what is the problem and its impact? So, we have a problem, the poor modern education infrastructure in rural government schools, and which leads to poor student enrollment, poor learning outcomes, low attendance, and low motivation and interest in education. And this is, we have observed from our internal survey, as well as there are reports from World Bank and few other agencies. You can see in right hand side, there is a classroom, and you can see the what condition of the classroom is having. And then what is the solution we are offering to this problem? So our solution is Project Study Mall, which is the concept from the shopping mall, which we want to offer all educational infrastructure, modern education infrastructure under one roof, which includes the modular library or a classroom library, a digital classroom, a solar power, the computer education program, and the more important is the community engagement, so that our project will be sustainable in the long term. If you look at the before and after school, so before study mall, you can look at it left hand side, the classroom, and after study mall, the classroom is with the full of modern education facilities, including digital learning tools, library, the colorful classroom. It is a well clean and hygiene, before and after. If you look at the from outside the school, you can see before how the school was and after how the school is decorated, including the the color, the grass, and everything, which is more presentable and more interesting for the students. So what our current reach, if I talk about, more than 9,000 students are benefited through our study mall program from 51 schools in 49 villages that spread across 13 districts. Year on year, we have grown from 2015-16 from just 3 study malls to 19-20, we reached to 51 study malls across the 49 villages. If I talk about the impact of our program, so the major impact is the student enrollment in the school. So if I look at the 60% of our school has shown that there is a growth in enrollment, where 33% are stable and only 7% are declined due to various other reasons. If I talk about the more impact, especially from the learning outcome, so if I look at the interest in education, 92% teacher says that the interest has been increased of the students, to attend the school because of the digital classroom, library, and other infrastructure provided. Even because of the digital learning, students understand the concept much better, and that you can see the 100% teachers has shown, the positive response. Yes, students are able to understand the concept much better way. Even similarly, the reading, the number of books they are reading, 3 to 4 books they are reading per week. And the reading habit also increase. If I talk about our model, so first we assess the school, then we community set up the basic infrastructure, then we set up the study mall, and then the monitoring, maintenance, and community engagement takes place. So if I talk about what is the unique proposition, so our model is different from other nonprofits so far in Maharashtra. No other organization in Maharashtra working on the similar model. We work to overall improvement of the schools, including infrastructure and creating positive learning environment in the village. So if I talk about the funding in past, so in last 2 year financial years, we have raised more than 40 lakhs rupees, and that's major comes from the CSR funding, the companies like ONGC, Tata, Google Endurance, Foams and Surfaces. So what we are our target we have? So target one is the new study mall centers, which we are targeting to set up in 100 rural government schools, and funding is required 1.5 crore over the period of 3 years. And target two, which is the immediate for next upcoming year, is to set up the Computer Mitra program, which is the computer education program in 15 schools. And for that, our budget is approximately 9 lakhs rupees. So the people behind the Thinchap Foundation, me, myself as a founder, started with the giving back to society approach with the background from B Computer Engineering and the MBA, and more than 10 plus years work experience in the financial sector. We have another full-time program manager, Mr. Amit Kutwal from the TIS Tuljapur. And there are bunch of volunteers and the part-time employees who are working with us as and when required. So that's it from my side. Thank you very much for your patience and listening to me. Thank you very much.
Thanks, Santosh. It was a very good presentation. Let me invite last presenter innovator in tribal innovation session, Pulgulan Foundation, which means Adivasi Janajagruti, by Nitesh Bharatwaj. Over to Nitesh.
नमस्कार, मैं नितेश भारद्वाज, मैं आदिवासी जन जागृति को रिप्रेजेंट कर रहा हूँ। पुणे से कुछ लगभग 5-550 किलोमीटर दूर है नंदुरबार जिला। अभी हम जब वाईफाई पर 4G कनेक्टिविटी पर एक दूसरे से जुड़े हुए हैं और चैट कर रहे हैं, तब नंदुरबार एक ऐसी जगह है जहाँ अभी भी लोग 2G, कई गाँव में 2G की कनेक्शन भी नहीं पहुंची हुई है। एक ऐसी जगह जहाँ पर अभी भी कई गाँव में लोगों को पीने के पानी के लिए कई किलोमीटर पैदल चलना पड़ता है और फिर पहाड़ से उतर करके उनको पानी लेने जाना पड़ता है। एक ऐसा गांव जहां पर अभी भी कई मूलभूत सुविधाएं नहीं पहुंच पाई हैं लोगों तक। शुरुआत में जब मैं नंदुरबार में था, मैंने इसके बारे में जब पता करने की कोशिश की तो मुझे पता लगा कि यहां पर कई सारी सरकारी योजनाएं हैं जो काम कर रही हैं। आदिवासी कल्याण के लिए जो भी योजनाएं बनाई जाती हैं उनको सबसे पहले नंदुरबार में ही इम्प्लीमेंट करवाया जाता है, मगर इसके बावजूद अगर उन नंदुरबार में उन योजनाओं का सही इस्तेमाल नहीं हो पा रहा है या सही तरीके से फायदा नहीं पहुंच पा रहा है, तो इसके पीछे जो मुझे जो समझ में आई वो ये वजह थी कि लोगों के बीच में और सरकार के बीच में एक बहुत बड़ा अंतर है। सूचनाओं का आदान प्रदान बहुत ही कमजोर है नंदुरबार में। हमने इसी चीज के लिए काम करने की शुरुआत की। हमारे पास हमने जो सोचा वो ये कि ऑडियो विजुअल मीडियम जो है वो सबसे अच्छा मीडियम है। अपनी इश्यूज को या अपने बातों को लोगों तक पहुंचा पाने के लिए, और उसमें भी अगर ये ऑडियो विजुअल मीडियम जो है वो लोकल भाषा में हो वहां की तो सबसे अच्छा है। हमारे पास क्योंकि रिसोर्सेज की कमी थी इसलिए हमने इस काम के लिए मोबाइल फोन्स का इस्तेमाल करना शुरू किया। हम मोबाइल फोन के माध्यम से लोकल भाषा में जो कि पावरी है, भिलोरी है, आयरनी है, इन भाषाओं में सरकार की योजनाओं के बारे में, उनको किस तरीके से उनका इस्तेमाल लिया जा सकता है इसके बारे में वीडियोस बनाते हैं और उनको अलग अलग ग्राम सभाओं में या एसएचजी मीटिंग्स में लोगों तक दिखाते हैं। साथ ही हम वहां की जो समस्याएं हैं, जो इश्यूज हैं, वो भी जमीन से उठा करके सरकार तक या जो भी कंसर्न लोग हैं उन तक पहुंचाते हैं ताकि उन समस्याओं पर काम किया जा सके। हमने कई सारे इश्यूज कवर किए हैं पिछले 4 सालों में, जैसे कि आमखेड़ी और तेलखेड़ी में पानी की समस्या है। हमने वहां पर पानी की समस्या दिखाई और उसका फायदा ये हुआ कि अभी सरकार की तरफ से, तालुका प्रशासन की तरफ से वहां हर रोज सुबह में एक पानी का टैंकर भेजा जाता है। हमने मिनी बैंक में करप्शन जो होते थे उसको उजागर किया। हर रोज मिनी बैंक में आप कोई भी ट्रांजेक्शन करने के लिए जाएं तो हर ट्रांजेक्शन के लिए 10 से 20 रुपए खर्च करने पड़ते थे। सुनने में 10 से 20 रुपए बहुत कम लगता है, लेकिन जब आप इतने बड़े पॉपुलेशन में उस पर काम करे तो आपको पता लगे कि रोज का ही लाखों का इलीगल ट्रांजैक्शन होता है। हमने इसके ऊपर कदम उठाया। हमारे इस कदम को उठाने की वजह से लोगों ने पैसे देने बंद किए और कई मिनी बैंक वाले जो पैसे लेते थे उनका लाइसेंस कैंसिल किया गया। ये हमारी अभी तक जो हमने की थी वो कुछ उदाहरण थे। हमारे यूनिक सेलिंग पॉइंट क्या है? सबसे पहला तो ये है कि हमारा सारा का सारा काम जो है वो लोकलाइज्ड है। इसको करने के लिए बाहर से कोई नहीं आ रहा। गांव के ही जो लड़के हैं वो अपने गांव के इश्यूज को उठा रहे अपनी गांव की भाषा में। ये हमारा एक यूनिक सेलिंग पॉइंट है। साथ ही साथ हमारे जो 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 हमारा काम है उसके 95% जो स्टेक होल्डर्स हैं वो वही के युवा हैं। कोई बाहर का आदमी उसमें इन्वॉल्व नहीं है। शायद इकलौता मैं हूं जो बाहर से हूं वहां पर। इसके अलावा हम न सिर्फ समस्याओं को उठाते हैं बल्कि इनको रिजॉल्व भी करते हैं। हम टाइम टू टाइम अपडेट लेते रहते हैं। हम सरकार से सवाल करते हैं कि जो समस्याएं उठाई गई हैं उनका समाधान कहां तक पहुंचा है। ये हमारे यूएसपी है। कंपटीशन तो खैर क्योंकि हम ये मीडिया स्पेस में काम करें, कम्युनिटी मीडिया में, नंदुरबार में हमारे पास वैसा कोई कंपटीशन नहीं है। बैरियर्स हैं, फाइनेंशियल बैरियर है जो कि लगभग हर शुरुआत में सारे ऑर्गेनाइजेशंस को फेस करना पड़ता है। पॉलिटिकल है क्योंकि हम लोगों की समस्याओं को उठाते हैं, हम दिखाते हैं जहां पर कई बार आप सरकार से सवाल करते हैं तो पॉलिटिकल हमें बैरियर्स मिलते हैं। सोशल चैलेंजेस हैं हमारे लिए क्योंकि कई बार हम ऐसी चीजों के ऊपर वीडियोस बनाते हैं या अवेयरनेस क्रिएट करते हैं जो कि वहां के जो एस्टैब्लिश्ड जो सोशल नॉर्म्स हैं उनको चैलेंज करते हैं। ये हमारे लिए 3 बैरियर्स हैं जो हमने आइडेंटिफाई किया है। फंडिंग हमारा जो हमारा बेसिक जो फंडिंग है वो हमारा मेन जो फंडिंग का पार्ट वो हमारे ट्रेनिंग में, ट्रैवलिंग में, वॉलंटियर मैनेजमेंट और स्टाइपेंड में चला जाता है। हम इस बार अभी हम नंदुरबार के सिर्फ एक तालुका में काम कर रहे हैं, धड़गांव तालुका में। हमने 2 और तालुकाओं में अपने आप को एक्सपैंड करने के लिए काम कर रहे हैं जिसके लिए हमें लगभग 1.5 लाख रुपए की जरूरत थी। कोरोना की वजह से हमने सिर्फ अभी तक 20,000 का ही फंडिंग रेज किया हुआ है। हमारा जो फंडिंग मॉडल जो है, जो हमारा करंट रेवेन्यू मॉडल, वो है हमारा एडवर्टीजमेंट है। लोकल एडवर्टीजमेंट्स लेते हैं जो हम अपने वीडियोस में डालते हैं, बहुत कम पैसे आते हैं उससे। यूट्यूब है, उससे बहुत कम पैसे आते हैं क्योंकि हमारे सब्सक्राइबर्स बहुत ज्यादा नहीं है। कम्युनिटी फंडिंग जो है हमारी सबसे बड़ी फंडिंग का सोर्स है जिससे हमें पैसा मिलता है और हम वॉलंटियर्स को मैनेज कर पाते हैं, हम बाकी अपने सारे काम कर पाते हैं। अभी जो हमने एक नया जो सोचा हुआ है वो प्रोडक्ट प्लेसमेंट है। एडवर्टीजमेंट्स तो हम कर ही रहे हैं और सब्सक्रिप्शन मॉडल पे भी हम काम करने का सोच रहे हैं। हमें क्या उम्मीद है, हम क्या चाह रहे हैं यहाँ से, वो एक तो मेंटोरशिप है क्योंकि हमें जो हम काम कर रहे हैं वो हमें पता है कि हमें उसका सक्सेस दिख रहा है, मगर उसको स्केल अप करना हो तो उसके लिए हमें गाइडेंस की जरूरत है, फंडिंग की जरूरत है। इसके अलावा रिकॉग्निशन, क्योंकि हमारे जो ज्यादातर वॉलंटियर्स जो काम कर रहे हैं वो पैसों के लिए नहीं कर रहे हैं बल्कि इसलिए कर रहे हैं क्योंकि उनको अपने समाज की समस्याओं को सुलझाना है, उनको अपनी पहचान बनानी है। तो ये सारी चीजें हैं जो हम उम्मीद कर रहे हैं पाने का, मिलने का। हमारी टीम जो है राकेश, अर्जुन और मैं खुद नितेश, हम फाउंडिंग मेंबर्स हैं। कल्पेश जो है वो हमारा वॉलंटियर पूरा मैनेज करते हैं और खुद विद्या देवका जो है वो एजुकेशन पर काम करती है हमारे लिए। हमारा जो प्लान है वो नेक्स्ट 6 मंथ्स का वो ये है कि अभी हम एक तालुका में काम कर रहे हैं, हम अगले कुछ महीनों में 3 तालुकाओं में बढ़ने वाले हैं और नंदुरबार के हर जिलों तक हम अपनी पहुंच बनाना चाहते हैं। अगले 3 सालों में हमारा टारगेट है कि 50 से हमारे वॉलंटियर्स की संख्या 200 हो जाए, 3 फुल टाइम मेंबर्स से 10 फुल टाइम मेंबर्स हो जाए और हम अपना खुद का एक मोबाइल एप्लीकेशन क्रिएट करना चाहते हैं। बहुत बहुत धन्यवाद। ये था मेरा छोटा सा प्रेजेंटेशन। धन्यवाद।
Thanks, Nitesh. It was good presentation. So in the tribal innovation session, we have completed 6 presentations which were scheduled. I personally could relate to all these presentations, each of these presentations, because I had worked as a tribal commissioner of Maharashtra state for 3 years, and I could see the importance of each of innovators' efforts. So it was really nice to hear all of them. Now it's time to have some dialogue with the innovators. The innovators are present over here. There are jury panel members who are also present over here. I will just read out names of jury panel members. Mr. Tushar Juvekar, Mr. Nag Subramanian, Ms. Bina Joshi, Reema Mohan, Ashish Garde, and Amol Chafekar. So now the session is open for interaction. Jury panel members can ask their queries, questions to the innovators. So over to jury panel members now.
Naga sir, you are on mute. You can unmute yourself.
Yeah, I've unmuted myself, and just want to address this to Nandurbagh. What are the challenges you are facing, but how are you putting in a proper process, you know, to ensure that there is a sizable opportunities available to tap here?
So, sir, yes, we are facing lot of you are talking about challenges, right, sir?
Not only challenges, I'm telling you what's an opportunity. You know, should be what happens. See, I don't know how the model you are using. See, I'm in a professional industry. I'm also heading CSR and all those things. Have you put your entire process in the PDA cycle, PDCA cycle, the Deming, famous Deming PDCA cycle, plan, do, check, and act? Have you planned your activity? Number one, have you checked your activity with the do, what you have done? Have you found out P minus D by the process of checking? What is the result? And there is a variance, adverse are the positive variance or negative variance. Have you taken a corrective action?
Yes,
sir. Anything so, sir, structured process. That's what I'm trying to understand, which I was not able to get in your presentation.
So, sir, we have already, we are working on this model from past 4 years. Yeah. This is the fourth year on this project. One of the things that this project is running successfully without even getting any funding from any organization or from any CSR. It's totally running by the community itself and on a volunteership method. Barriers we have actually identified a positive risk and negative risk. So positive risks we have, a positive risk is one, which is like, so our volunteers are now politically aware. And this is a positive risk for us, because since they are politically aware, they do take part in Gram Sabhas, they do take part in all the other activities, which is political and which is official. They go and ask officials about what is going on. So it's a positive risk for us. Negative risk is also with us. So we do check that we have, so since we are making content and we are sending it, we are screening it to other people and we are sharing it on different social media platforms. So one of the negative risks is that we have to check time to time that all our volunteers do ethical jobs. They don't involve in corruption practices since we are into media space. How we are tackling it? I myself and Rakesh and Arjun, two of our co-founders, we all make sure that every videos, whatever we are uploading, we just verify it by our own. So this is how. So since we have a small team right now, we do verify each and every content. Also, positive risk, when I'm saying, sir, there's one more thing, that few of our team members are actually taking part in electoral politics, which I consider is a positive risk. Apart from that, what is the future of this project, if I'm not wrong in understanding this?
What I wanted to impress upon you, that are we going by a very structured process with a timeline chart, and have you, and this is point number one, and have you explored the for tribal development with our tribal commissioner who has already spent good amount of time in this thing. There are funding available. Have you explored those opportunities also?
No, sir, not now. Since we are working in a very smaller space, we don't have that opportunity.
Do not know that the funding available from the government.
No, sir, we have not explored it till yet. But
we explored it and we have our esteemed tribal commissioner who is chairing today, who has spent a lot of time. Why didn't you interact with him? Am I correct? There are tribal community, there are funding available from the government. So why didn't you explore it?
Funding is available. You are absolutely right. Funding is available. And I will suggest Nitesh to approach our project office over there. There are so many schemes. We will definitely encourage good work.
And I want to because I might be asking too many questions. I had to give the opportunity to other jury members. I think I'll request other jury member to take over and put their queries. Thank you very much. It is anyway, it is a very good attempt we have made. Really, I congratulate you. You're doing an excellent job. Perhaps I'll give you a little bit of input. That's what I thought. I just put a small query.
Thank you
very much. Have a nice time and wish you all the best.
So what a common question for all the participants out here. When we're talking about a tribal or a rural category, I would specify to a tribal category because this category is a tribal category. There would be a challenge that you must have faced in communicating with the tribal community. And how do you plan to address that, or what is your outreach plan for that tribal community? That is question number one, or how you're addressing it. Question number two is, apart from donations or funding or CSR, what is your revenue source, a sustainable revenue source when you are dealing with the tribal community out there? So,
Amul, is this a question specific to any innovator, or this is a common question?
Typically, if we can go for Dakti craft, which are more relevant to it, and GEI, they are the ones which are most relevant to the tribal outreach part of it. But the question remains common for all, that if they have to communicate with the tribal community, which is not a rural community,
right?
What are the challenges and how they would overcome it?
I'll request Gopal Krishnan to take this question from Dakti Craft. Gopal?
Yeah, sure, sir. I hope you can see and hear me.
Yes, absolutely.
Okay, yeah, sir, to address your first question, in terms of the communication, though Rita and Peter, my colleagues who are in Meghalaya right now, would be in a better position to, since they work at the grassroots level, but from my understanding, it takes a lot of time. That is the very first thing. It's not just the language barrier or the culture barrier, but it's actually the trust factor. Because the very first thing is that they come from a world which is very isolated to anything from outside their region, even if it may be from the very same state. So the very first factor for us to barrier to cross is the trust factor. And that we realized comes only with time and not with money or any kind of a payback that we can put.
I got it for one from Thermax.
And so we spent a lot of time with them. And we had to sort of not be educated ourselves. We had to educate them about the importance of what we are doing and why we cannot do it without them. And only when they are on board and understand that they are playing a very important role in the job that we have taken up is when they are willing to, in fact, take the dialogue forward. So for them, so that is number one, the trust factor.
Yeah.
And if I may ask you to repeat the second question, please.
Second question, in your case, it is pretty clear. You're making money by the sale of the products.
Yes.
That's a very clear statement.
Right.
Apart from your startup, there are startups who are kind of dependent on the funding part of it in terms of CSR or donations. And so, do they have any alternative plan in mind to generate certain revenue source to make their startup sustainable?
We have Rida and Peter also joining us from Meghalaya. Yeah, Gopal.
Rida, you want to talk about the alternate sources of income that we have other than our sales?
Okay, sure. In fact, when we started
you know, with the marketing, the products, we started with training, and that's how Dakti started. When we went to the villages, we have an interaction, and eventually we became more like a community where we learn from each other. And eventually that becomes a source. I think what Dakti eventually...
Sorry to interrupt you. DaktiCraft, it is clear. You're making sales. It's a sustainable model that we can understand. You're making a sale and then the money is coming back.
Right.
If I can ask the same question to, say, let's say, GEI, how would they, change it across?
Can I, Mandar, can I put my thoughts?
Yeah.
Okay. So Amol, I represent Thinksha Foundation, and we also deal with the tribal schools.
Santosh, Atso is here, so let him quickly answer and we'll come to you.
Yes. So,
Atso, can you hear us?
Yes.
Yeah,
hello.
So the question was specifically to you, so can you just quickly answer and then we go to Santosh?
Okay, the first question. Okay, I would like to say a sentence regarding that. So the first question is like, yes, our team is not to change what it is, but like to promote and also to develop the instrument. Yeah, so that is also one area that is a challenge for us to deal with it with the traditional people. And the second question is like, we develop different models and the revenue through sales and services, we return the fund.
No.
That's it. Thank you. Okay, Santosh, you were adding to
Amol, your question was really, valid question. Okay, being a non-profit, we face the challenge. How we will be sustainable? The point number one, when we get the CSR funds, so we make sure that when we are applying or approaching to any corporate, our program will be sustainable for over the period of 3, 4, 5 years, whatever. Till the time we are with the school, we'll make sure that the money is sponsored by that corporate on our admin cost. Second, now being a nonprofit, as we know, we are completely dependent on donations and CSR funds. Now we are also working on creating another line of products, which will be not a main our revenue model, but which can be a sustainable to our organization, especially the admin cost. So let's say, in this month, we have started the storybooks. The storybooks we are going to publish, and the storybooks will be available at very affordable cost to all the tribal communities. They can buy at just 5 rupees or 10 rupees a storybook, and they can have a wonderful experience of having access to good storybooks. That way, we have a few more products and services in pipeline. We are building that so that our operational cost will be covered and Thinksha Foundation will be sustainable for the longer period of time. Thank you very much.
Okay, so
do you have a question?
Yeah. Yes. So first of all, I would like to compliment each and every one of you, because it's very easy to ask questions and ask for clarifications, but it's very extremely tough to work on the field. And I can see that each one of you is indeed addressing a unique problem. So I want to ask Santosh, you just said that you have new books will be available at a cheaper cost. So are these books in the tribal dialects, or what language are they in?
Okay, so right now we don't have a books in a tribal language, because in Maharashtra, mostly all the schools, whether it's a tribal or the normal Marathi medium school, they have a same, the syllabus or the academic pattern. So far we are not getting into the specific tribal language. Now, where we work in the tribal community is mostly in the Palghar or the Raigad, and they speak very well fluent Marathi. Yes, I understand if you go to the Nandurbar and the other part of the Vidarbha side, probably you will face that challenge and we will come up with the alternate solution that point of time. But as of now, if we look at our challenge is not the the language, but the challenge is only to sustain ourselves and make products and services available to the tribal communities at very affordable price.
Okay, thank you. So I also want to ask Fishy Farmers, so since you have entered under the tribal innovation category, can you please elaborate on how you're including the tribals in your whole organization and your business plan?
Hello, very good evening to one and all. Am I audible?
Yes.
Yes.
Yeah, actually, we at Fishy Farmers have improved the filtration system which is being used by NFDB till date. So, which overall reduced the cost of filtration system, which was supposed to go into the construction of the fish systems. Now, this improved the return on investment which the tribal communities are getting after the subsidy is also given. So, in this way, we have overall reduced the cost of construction of the fish systems through NFDB and also helping the tribals get back their subsidy, which was promised through them through Blue Revolution schemes.
So I think you really have got a very unique proposition. Are you the only one doing it in India, or are you aware of anybody else who is also into this now?
Actually, to be frank, ma'am, the aquaponics as a system, there are two other systems in India. One is in Bangalore and the other one is in Uttarakhand. But the difference we draw, the parallels we have are that the technology of using the same water for fish and plants is same. But the differentiating aspect is that of our filtration system, where we use recycled copper wool.
Okay.
Which overall reduces the price of the filtration system. That is the great advantage, and which gives us an advantage to penetrate deeper into the rural economy.
Okay. Thank you. Thank you very much.
Thanks a lot.
Hi, Tushar here. I have a question for Atso. Atso from Netherlands. Hi, Atso.
Hello.
Yeah, hello. Atso.
Yes.
Really good innovation, and I appreciate your efforts to for your passion in art and culture.
Yes.
So I have two questions. One is how many such instruments you sold till date, and the second one is how you will take this instrument out of Kohima. So if you want to convince the importance and the use of this instrument to a musician in Bollywood, what would be your strategy or how you will sell it?
Okay. Okay, the first question, to answer the first question. Yes, hello.
Yeah, go ahead.
Yeah, so right now our team has, we have started this thing. It's in the first phase only. Mm-hmm. We have started this GIO instrument since 2016, and we introduced it officially in the year 2017. Mm-hmm. And we have developed the player model around six only now, till now. And we have sold it last year. Mm-hmm. And regarding your second question, that is also one of our challenges. And in the years to come, that is also our plan to take it out of Nagaland, out of Kohima. That's a very good question. So it will be through collaborating and also performances, and try to collaborate with famous musicians who will be interested in the instrument and the sound of the instrument.
Okay.
Yes.
I have a question to you. I'm sorry, I'll just take half a minute. Already people have taken. See, you are doing a wonderful job. Let me tell you, there is a huge demand for the musical instruments to overseas.
Mm-hmm.
Because people are fed up of this electronic instrument, they need a touch. Mm-hmm. There's a huge demand. Sir. Have you tried any of the social marketing, the online media, online marketing platform to put your product? I can tell you that you'll get a huge response. Many people are interested because people are now slowly getting conventional, there's electronic, that in one thing you get all the varieties of instruments, varieties of music, everything you get it. Now people are all going for a conventional instrument. In fact, the one which you are doing it is an excellent one. People want to give a touch, human touch. There is a human touch. In electronic, there is no human touch. In your case, there is a human touch, and there is a huge potential overseas. And have you tried for that? Have you tried any of the social marketing media to put your product? I can tell you that you can get good amount of response.
Okay.
Not yet, sir.
First,
go to Amazon, go to there are social online platforms are there. You can sell anything. Only thing is that your product is something very good, which will have a huge demand. Thank you very much, and for preserving the heritage of Nagaland.
Yeah, thank you. Thank you.
Can I ask one more question?
Please go ahead. Sure, Biraji, yeah. Please go ahead. Yeah.
So I want to ask Rida of Dakti Crafts. First thing is, I think she said black pottery, right? Or so what is the uniqueness of that? And secondly, you're working with a lot of women. So what have you seen in the earnings they have? And do you have any idea as to how are they using that additional money they have earned?
So with black clay pottery, in fact, when we first went to the village, in fact, this pottery is called the Larnai pottery. It's practiced in one village, not in Tarsham, this particular village that we are working with. So eventually, I think over the years, we've seen that, you know, there's lots of interests have changed and people have kind of, you know, got more interested because I think the way we interact, we went and spent a lot of time and seen how, you know, we can create opportunity with these women who are practicing, because I don't think so their kids would be interesting. They're sending their children to school and we didn't see that maybe in the long run there'll be anybody else practicing the craft. So, but now we are introducing through design, through understanding the market. So we are trying to kind of highlight this platform for even the artisans. We take them and, you know, create that awareness, not just for us, but for the artisans, where they get introduced and see, you know, how they can actually develop this particular craft and earn a living out of it. So in fact, for the past few years, I think with the village that we're working with, the Tarsham women, they have really we have really raised their livelihood, because now they're not doing it as a part-time job. It's become a full-time. We have a lot of production going on to date so far. And with the black clay pottery, the uniqueness of this craft is because of the wellness, of the process involved. Everything is natural and the uniqueness of the craft. So over the years, I think myself using this pot and, you know, cooking in it, I can feel the difference. And I think, you know, the speciality, especially in the Korean, the technique that these women practice has to be preserved. So that is one way that we are looking, yeah.
Thank you.
Mandar, I'm Ashish here. I would like to ask a quick question to all the teams. Basically, I have three questions. Has any of the team ever approached any business incubator for scaling up of their business? The next is, what specific initiatives they are doing for capacity building of their teams so that they can scale up their business? And do they have any specific plan on paper for accelerating their business?
Is this a question specific to anybody, any innovator? Ashish ji?
Anyone can answer, whosoever is working on these three areas.
May I take the question,
sir? Yes, sir. Yeah, please.
Hello, sir. So we are incubated at AIDEA NAM. It's an agricultural innovation incubation center. At the same time, the capacity building which the incubation center offered us was to connect us with all the local NGOs and FPOs who were looking to improve their revenue through new technological innovations. So that was one advantage, and that was the incubation center we are part of, sir. And during this process, we have also raised a seed funding of 25 lakhs from the incubation center through BIREC.
Thank you, Sai. Okay, I think the Q&A session, we had quite a lot of questions. I would like to thank Dr. Kiran Kulkarni for taking
time. I will just have some reflection, Manja.
Yes.
It was very interesting discussion.
Yeah.
And government officer attending such discussion is also a very good thing for learning. Actually speaking, I will like to reflect on two issues which are raised in this discussion particularly. One is, of course, there is difference in rural and tribal. As Amol was mentioning, There is some difference. Tribal is a bit different thing, and challenges in rural areas are a bit different. So one has to understand that. Then yes, tribal dialects are very important. They are now extinguishing, and that is the thing of concern. To give you an example, in Maharashtra, there are 181 tribes who are living in Maharashtra. So it is not homogeneous group. It is heterogeneous. 181 tribes in only Maharashtra. If we speak about India, there are at least 900 tribes, scheduled tribes, that is Adivasis. And in Maharashtra, there are 40 dialects which are spoken among Adivasis. Out of those 40, 11 dialects are of a nature that 80% tribal people are speaking those dialects. So these are the challenges. It is always nice to say, and it is required also to translate good books and primers in tribal dialects. And I am happy to, I will be happy to share here that we have done that in 11 tribal dialects. We have translated our first to third primers, total 44 books in all 11 dialects. So that apart. Another important issue which was raised, it was about revenue model and financial sustainability. So my experience says that market network with mainstream is the key, whatever be the product or service. If we can establish successful marketing network, then it is okay. Otherwise, it is not going to sustain. So CSR support, government scheme support should be there for market networking with mainstream. That is my observation during my service also. So the best way out is initial support should be given through CSR or through government scheme. There are so many government schemes which are giving now viability gap funding also. So that can also be explored. But CSR and government support in initial stages, and then sustainability, financial sustainability through successful marketing network with mainstream society is the key. That's what my observation is. Anyway, it was a very nice experience. Thanks to all, thanks to organizers for calling me, and congratulations to all innovators, and thanks to jury panel members. Thanks.
Thank you so much, Dr. Kiran Kulkarni, for giving us time today and sharing this tribal innovation session. And also would like to thank the panel of jury who are the heads of various corporates, CSR heads, to name Tushar Juvekar is from KPIT, Mr. Naga Subramaniam from RSB Transmission, Ms. Bina Joshi from Forbes Marshall, we had Ms. Reema Mohan from NSC, Ashish Garde, who has been part of Magic Accelerator, and Mr. Amol Safekar, who has been an investor and also founder of OVA Incorporation. So thank you very much, all of you. And my colleague will be in touch with you for the criteria and judging formalities. Thank you all. And with this, I would like to invite Dr. Vijay Kelkar, Vice President of PIC, to do the concluding remarks. Dr. Vijay Kelkar, sir. Over to you, sir. You're on mute.
Can you hear me?
Yes, sir. We can hear you.
Yeah. First, let me congratulate all the innovators for their extremely inspiring presentations. As Dr. Kulkarni mentioned, that the tribal areas are not most easy to work with in terms of problems of logistics, problems of language. The problem being very different than what one comes across. So it requires very special efforts by our young men and our women. And I'm really impressed by each one of the presentations to all of them. I also want to thank the jury members. They took time at our request and made a very, very important contribution. And we're all waiting for their deliberations and what results will be tomorrow. I want to take this opportunity to really acknowledge my own gratitude and also the gratitude of the organization and also innovators of our mentors of the PIC. These are all our founder members of PIC, Sri Sanjay Kanwinde, Sri Pramod Atle, Sri Kasmalkar, Girendra Kasmalkar, Sri Amit Anil Kulkarni, Sri Ram Iyer, and Sri Amit Bhargava. I cannot thank them enough because what they have given is they're really, if you ask me, provide zing to this program because they have taken from idea to market very successfully. And some of the success, as Hitendra Singh pointed out right in the beginning, some of the success have been very spectacular and inspiring. So I want to really give my personal gratitude to them and also the gratitude of behalf of all the innovators, also on the behalf of PIC. And I also want to thank all the enterprises, CSR colleagues from different enterprises. This particular year, we are very gratified and we're grateful to the very generous support of CSR work the group of JSW and Lupin Pharma. I mean, their support has been very valuable in conducting this program. So, and I hope and look forward to get their continued support. As Dr. Mashalkar mentioned, our chief guest mentioned this morning, the social innovation is going to be, is one of the most important activity. I think we have to nurture. And is and I want to thank both Hitendra Singh and now his distinct and his very able successor, Manda Joshi, for creating and nurturing this, our social innovation. With these remarks, brief remarks, I want to thank all and suggest that we close today's session, close the session of the National Conference on Social Innovation. And all of us are looking forward for tomorrow's exciting presentation. And of course, the results from our respective juries. Thank you all.
Thank you, Dr. Kelkar. Thank you for your concluding remarks. And as he rightly said, tomorrow we start sharp at 3 with rural and urban innovators presenting, just like the tribal innovators presented today, their innovation. So I look forward to see you all tomorrow joining us for the day 2 of this conference. Look forward to see you all. Thank you, and we call it a day. Vaidya sir, thank you very much for your presence, and we will connect with you to inform you and give you more details on what are our initiatives. Thank you so much, everybody. Have a good evening.
Thank you.